Good morning and welcome our panelists today, the NRC staff and the members of the public. The purpose of today's meeting is to discuss the status of actions taken by the NRC in response to and the industry in response to the lessons learned from the Fukushima Dai-ichi accident, including a discussion of progress on NRC's Tier 1 activities and the status of open Tier 2 and Tier 3 recommendations. We'll begin with presentations from the external panel, which includes Anthony Petrangelo, Chief Nuclear Officer of the Nuclear Energy Institute, Ken Canavan, Director of Plant Technology, Electric Power Research Institute, Randy Blunt from Southern Nuclear Company, Chairman of the BWR Owners Group Fukushima Response Committee, and Paul Gunter, Director of the Reactor Oversight Project of Beyond Nuclear. Following the external panel, we'll have a brief break and then hear from the NRC staff. I look forward to the presentations and discussions this morning. Before we begin, do my colleagues have any opening remarks? If not, we'll start with Mr. Petrangelo with the presentations on the external panel.
Okay. Chairman, thanks. Commissioners, good morning. In summary, we continue to make good progress on implementing the Fukushima lessons learned. I'll touch on a number of items in the presentation of what we think we're very well aligned with completion in 2016 and some issues we're still trying to wrestle. Going to slide two, we will be largely complete with flex implementation in the industry by the end of this year. And with respect to the pool instrumentation orders, completion by the end of this year, with BWR Mark I and two vents complete in 2018 and 19 as previously laid out. We're continuing to focus on flex inspections. I think we noted last time here that we want to make sure that all the work we've done in the previous 5 years to get a common understanding of what it takes to implement the requirements and the orders carries through to the field inspection and implementation by licensees. We fully support the staff on the disposition of the Tier 2 and 3 actions, made excellent progress there. We are committed to completing the majority of the mitigating strategy assessments before the rulemaking. That, I think, is consistent with our bias for action since the Fukushima event in 2011. And the rulemaking really aligns a lot of the significant activities that have been undertaken by us and the NRC. There's a few issues to discuss, which I'll touch on briefly. Next slide, please. Here's the detailed implementation on flex status. 58 units will be complete, are already complete. 29 are finishing up this year. There'll be an additional 13 that are substantially complete, but still dealing with the exception of the severe accident capable event. That's 100 sites, including, or 100 units, including Watts Part 2. Next slide, please. Flex inspections. The big thing with the inspection process, and I think we noted this last fall, is there's a lot of work that's been done, but we've seen in the past instances where a lot of that work is reinterpreted in the inspection process. So we want to make sure that the knowledge transfer from the folks that have been working on it in the agency here, as well as in the industry, is transferred out to the field. So what was maybe a couple of hundred people working on the implementation guidance and the rules and requirements, et cetera, now it's thousands of people who are expected to implement this going forward. So there's a big knowledge transfer that has to take place. We're committed to doing that in the right way. We've actually established a task force that'll meet with some of the folks here tomorrow on the inspection process. We're trying to promote consistency and implementation in the industry. I suspect we'll establish a frequently asked question panel, if you will, on the industry side to share lessons learned. If there's questions on interpretations of the guidance in the field, we'll have people who have already been working on these things for the last 5 years ready to answer questions and share that with the staff. So we're trying to get out in front of this as best we can. The industry task force does represent the entire fleet of plants. So we've got every company playing on that. And we want to make sure that we're learning from the inspections and making adjustments as necessary. I also want to make a point about the use of flex equipment here. We all know what its beyond design basis functions are for mitigation, but we are starting to use and will use more frequently flex equipment as an additional layer of defense in depth for more traditional things we do. We've actually submitted two white papers to the staff on getting credit for the use of flex and notices of enforcement discretion and in the significance determination process. I think that's just the tip of the iceberg of where we intend to apply the flex equipment. I think it's a win-win overall because it'll get this equipment hooked up and used and more familiarized with the plant staffs, and as well as the inspector seeing us use that equipment in different applications beyond waiting for the beyond design basis event to run out and do this. So again, I think it's a win-win overall. Next slide, please. This is the projected schedule of the mitigation strategy assessments. Again, before the final rule is issued, we'll have basically completed most of the MSAs for flooding this year, and on path with seismic for about two-thirds by the end of 2017. You can see the rest there. This is the major part of the licensee work this year, is conducting these mitigation strategy assessments against the reevaluated hazards. You'll get a lot more detail in the staff's presentation, but we're well on our way to completing the bulk of these assessments this year. Next slide. For the seismic SRAs, the current focus is for those plants in what we call Path 5, of the where their GMRS, or the ground motion response spectra, was greater than 2 times the safe shutdown earthquake. We think the proposed rule has sufficient language in it to allow a risk-informed approach there. We have to keep in mind that we're utilizing the seismic PRA results to assess the potential reduction for only the extended loss of AC power and the loss of ultimate heat sink. That's the focus of those. For plants that are less than the 2 times the SSC, or the safe shutdown earthquake, we do think there's a limited benefit that we'll get out of those seismic PRAs, and that if their mitigation strategies assessments are done right, it'll demonstrate the effectiveness of those using the deterministic approach there. Next slide on the flooding integrated assessments. We've put a lot of time into the external flooding assessment guidelines and provided that last month to the agency for endorsement. This looks at the methodology, trying to reduce some of the conservatisms in the initial methods. Again, we're utilizing the mitigating strategies for the local intense precipitation hazard. And in this one, again, we don't see significant flood risk reduction expected by performing these integrated assessments, given that the MSAs will have been done previously. We are trying to strike some balance of protection and mitigation with this integrated assessment as we go through the process. It's a limited number of plants will be using that full methodology. Turning to the next slide on the proposed rule. We think, again, the rule incorporates all of the requirements from 2012 and beyond. We are focused on the codification of the existing requirements and their integration. This is the beyond design basis framework, regulatory framework. I think this really did address recommendation one that the task force came up with initially. We support issuance of the rule in 2017. We provided comments in February. There's a couple issues on the implementation schedule, although I think we're on a good path to work those out. We don't want to be in a position where we're asking for exemptions from the rule as these mitigating strategy assessments are completed when we know how long they're going to take now. So we'd rather have the rule reflect that versus go for exemptions later. The change control process, we believe it should be different from what we do for design basis materials. So we're still working with the staff on that. And there's a couple of nits, I think, in the reevaluated hazard methodology that we're still working through. But overall, I think there's a good alignment on what we thought was going to be in the proposed rule and final rule and what the staff drafted. So in summary, we've had significant safety enhancements. We're well on our way to completing the implementation of the Fukushima lessons learned. We've had a focus on safety throughout, and I'm very proud of the fact that the industry has maintained a very high safety record and performance, both with reliability and safety, as we've been implementing the Fukushima lessons learned. 2016 is a critical year for completion of a lot of our enhancements. I said it last fall, and I'll say it again, we're still not done yet, though. There's still a lot of work to do with the mitigating strategies assessments, some of the reevaluated hazard work. So there's still work to do, and in particular, a focus on the inspection process. We are committed to maintain a focus on our equipment and these safety enhancements going forward. And again, we intend to utilize the flex equipment for other applications to improve defense and depth and safety. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Canavan.
Good morning. And thank you for having me here today to share some thoughts on both the lessons learned and some perspectives on some of the future research that we see. I'm going to sprinkle my lessons learned sort of around the presentation. Hopefully it's not too distracting. So before I get into the body of the slides, let me share one observation that I had in the hours and days after Fukushima, which was when Fukushima occurred, as with most severe accident type situations, there was a scarcity of information. And as that information started to become available, there was an interesting thing that I noticed, that some folks understood the severity of the events more than others. And one community that understood the severity of those events almost immediately was risk analysis people at the sites and at other organizations throughout the nuclear industry. And in the United States, we have a large community of risk analysis practitioners, which is unusual. And we have those because, as a result of generic letter 8820 issued in 1988 in response to post-TMI actions. And that generic letter required each utility to perform an individual plan examination for severe accident vulnerabilities. And one of the stated goals of that generic letter was to develop an understanding of severe accident behavior. These are actions that the NRC took that I think provided unique benefit to the U.S. nuclear industry when you think about it. With that appreciation of severe accidents came improvements in the form of hardware modifications, human performance improvements, changes to procedures, severe accident guides, all came out of that effort. In retrospect, positioned the U.S. Nuclear industry better to handle off-normal events. Next slide. So what's happened since Fukushima? Well, since Fukushima, EPRI and others have performed a significant body of technical work, too much to really talk about all of it today. So I've summarized a few of it, put it into categories in the blue, immediate actions, short-term actions, and sort of a longer-term understanding. And I'm going to cover some of the highlights. The items in red I have some slides on. And like I said, I'll cover a few of the highlights, my personal favorites, actually. Without further ado, but before moving on, another lesson learned from Fukushima is that the spent fuel pool and, in fact, the nuclear plants are very rugged structures. And when we look at that, that's supported by the fact that all available evidence currently indicates that after the seismic event, which was the fourth largest recorded seismic event and located just 100 miles away, all of the safety systems operated as designed. And research activities to date continue to support the ruggedness of both the fuel pool and the plant. In the area of immediate response, EPRI assisted TEPCO, a long-term EPRI member, in understanding severe accidents and analysis of the spent fuel pools, looking at potentials for criticality, and quickly helping to design a system to treat water. The shorter-term actions occurred in the months and years after the accident and include updates to severe accident technical basis document, which serves as one input to the severe accident guidelines that the owners groups will talk about in just a little bit, as well as development of strategies to mitigate radiological releases and accelerated seismic activities. And some of the long-term research activities were listed on the previous slide, and we'll discuss them as we walk through the presentation. But for seismic, the post-Fukushima era, we accelerated our existing seismic program, accelerated and expanded, to look at improving an understanding of the seismic hazard or the ground motion all the way from the seismic source through ground motion attenuation and site amplification to understand the true seismic hazard at the site. And then once understanding the seismic hazard at the site, evaluating components both for the impact of high-frequency motions and to better understand component performance in seismic events, commonly referred to as fragility analysis. And all of that's to better understand and then to mitigate seismic risk. Again, first is an understanding, then there's a mitigation. Next slide, please. So shortly after Fukushima, TEPCO engineers were very interested in all the research performed after Three Mile Island, as we can all understand, another notable accident. And NEPRI had just completed a draft archive of the 30-year body of scientific work that had been performed, and the draft was provided to TEPCO, and that draft eventually became an NEPRI report. I'll cite it here, 102-26-21-86, Technical Foundations of Reactor Safety, Revision 1. But that contains a large body of that 30 years of scientific work. And the reason why I mention that is because the Fukushima technical evaluation continues on a similar vein. So work continues in that area now to collect that information again and to make sure that it's available both to develop a deep understanding of Fukushima, to support sound technical decision making in the future. And one of the lessons learned in that document that I always find very, those documents, because there are several, a phase one and a phase two and several other supporting documents. But one of the most interesting things I always find about that document that's not well known is the fact that Unit 2, which is estimated to have the least amount of core damage and also had no hydrogen explosion, is actually the largest contributor to the radiological release. And so if you look at that chart that we see a lot of, that NNSA chart that shows the radiological release in a picture, that's largely due to Unit 2. Next slide, please. So accident-tolerant fuels, what would the nuclear industry be like if we had no zirconium in the core? And while there are several definitions of accident-tolerant fuel, they all share a common element, which is an increased ability to tolerate a loss of active cooling for a longer duration than the existing zirconium system. And a longer duration means more time for prevention and more time for mitigation. It means less hydrogen and reduced or minimal fission product release. So overall, it would look a lot different. There's a lot of different strategies for fuel systems and a lot of things to consider when designing new fuel. But two of EPRI's favorites are the molybdenum cladding concept, which is actually a zircaloy cladded molybdenum, both on the inside and outside. Because if you think about it, if you take molybdenum and you clad it with zirc on the inside and outside, very thin layer, you don't have a lot of zirc, but you do have the water and the fuel still seeing zirconium, so you don't change chemistry or physical properties as much. And silicon carbide fuel channels, which again replaces zirconium with a silicon carbide. Both have higher melting points, both have higher resilience and strength. There are other concepts, but this is part of the longer term research that we see being potentially a game changer for the nuclear industry. EPRI's role in this is to accelerate the collaboration and the development. Not one entity will not develop new fuel on its own. It's quite an endeavor. But the goal would be for test assemblies to be available in the early 2020s. Next slide, please. So in summary, there's a significant body of research and development that's been completed since Fukushima by EPRI and others, and much has been learned and implemented, and the global nuclear industry is safer as a result. I did want to close with one additional thought, that as we look at future research and development, it falls into two bins, really. One is the continuous improvement type of work, and through improved understanding and implementation of those learnings, we get better performance in terms of both safety and economics. But also, and the items in this bucket are things like learning on severe accidents, external hazard analysis, and other areas. But there's a second bin that provides a more significant step change, such as the accident-tolerant fuel we just discussed, as well as things like severe accident prognostics that would allow us to faster than real-time simulate accidents and be able to both prevent and mitigate better. And things like a new reactor technology, such as molten salt reactors, which I'm hoping is a subject of a future commission brief. And that's the end of my prepared comments.
Thank you. Mr. Bunn?
Yes, thank you for allowing me to present today and present on behalf of the Beat of Our Owners Group and our chairwoman, Lisa Hill, who's not able to be here. Do you want to go over a few topics, if you go to the next slide, talking about the lessons learned and where do we stand and what's remaining for the BWR fleet going forward. So we'll give you a brief status of where we stand from our flex strategies, then go over severe accident hardware and containment vent systems, our procedures, both the severe accident and the emergency operating procedures, and our aids of the TS technical support guideline documents going forward? And then what are we doing in support of what Tony had already mentioned about the mitigating strategies rule and the other elements associated with that? So next slide, please. So updated status of where we stand with the strategies. Industry-wide, BWR fleet has followed the industry lead, and we are very close to being finished by the end of this year in the primary elements that make up the flex strategies. We will have a few outstanding items for the event to enhance that going forward after the summer of 16, and that will take us into the 18 time period. Many units will be coming in 17 and the early 18 in accordance with that rule to enhance their venting associated with that. Approximately about a third of the fleet of the BWRs will submit their final integrated plans for documenting their closure of flex by in 2016. The remainders will be submitting those after their enhancements to the vents per the schedule that's outlined. We expect two plants to have their flex inspections in the 2016 time period, which will lay the foundation for where we're going forward for the inspections for the BWR fleets in the future years. Most of those inspections will come after their FIPs are done, so they'll be a little the tail end of those inspections where the PWRs will be the main focus with that. Also looking to establish how the mitigating strategies assessments both for flooding and seismic are working, and the BWR fleet is in line with the schedule that Tony had already presented for the most of the floodings to be done in 2016 and then the seismics to be spread out 16 and 17. Next slide, please. To go into the order, the 109 for the Mark 1 and Mark 2 units that are specifically out there with the hardware part, which is the phase one part of that order, complete by the 2018 time period, and then the phase two, which is the strategy, complete by 19. Many sites will be doing the strategy earlier than that, but their commitment is in the 19 time period. The impacted has said that we'll have their hardware installed by mid-2018 with in compliance with that order and the agreed-to schedule. The strategy part is the water addition and the water management that we'll see. We expect to see the staff evaluations for that integrated plans by this summer. Those integrated plans were submitted last year at the end of the year in December. A very concentrated effort between the staff and the industry to have a consolidated or a very typical submittal on that. So this, all the sites followed the template. Very good was done for across the industry in having the templates and trying to look like an industry when we submitted our reports as a P independent. So we expect to see closure when we go forward with these activities through inspections that'll happen in the 18 to 20 time period. Following the compliance with that, we expect to see the integrated plans and the safety staff assessments to be the basis for those inspections going forward. So that's how we see this hardened vents activity going forward. So next slide, please. So this is a brief status of where we stand with in the procedure suite of activities for the owners group, broken into the three categories of the procedures, the emergency operating procedures. The bulk of those lessons learned have been submitted. They're out there in the current revision, revision three. Full implementation of that revision is expected by mid-2017. The majority of the lessons learned required for the flex support from the direct application have already been implemented at the majority of sites to further compliance of their 2016 flex materially complete. For the severe accident guidelines, the owners group committed in their letters last year to be upgraded by the middle of 17 for the Rev 3. And they're also, most units are complying to have that done for their vent order, the 109 order compliance also. So their schedule is in that ahead of their compliance for a few plants, but the majority of plants are there. Several plants, a couple plants have already had that implementation done as of 2016. For our technical support guidelines, these are the calculational aids that allow the TSC staff, the technical support center staff, to have more tools, and also the operating crews to have more tools into how to evaluate. Those are have been issued, and workshops have been held in the U.S. this year, and there'll be more next year. And they also were held internationally for the BWR fleets in 2015. So that's an example of where we're spreading the lessons learned. Those were enhanced through activities and also support from both EPRI and from DOE, and some of the activities that support that from a code standpoint and evaluations that go forward. Next slide, please. For the proposed rule out there, the BWRs are in line with the rest of the industry, following the same industry schedule. We don't anticipate any changes or any delays that'll happen because of the BWR fleets in complying with the rule language, and very supportive of that. So we do expect, you know, our documentation enhancements needed for the mitigating strategies as we do that work in advance of the rule coming out across the industry. Also, how will the demonstrations and procedures be impacted from Flex going forward? And then what is the full documentation required for the rulemaking going forward, being that most of the compliance will have already taken place prior to the rule coming out? So those are where we see, very consistent with the rest of the industry, the BWRs are just where you ask for the information. Next slide, please. And in summary, we feel that the BWR fleet will be materially complete with Flex so that we will be able to cope with the mitigation of any external event. Currently, the bulk of the fleet are there. Also, the enhancement through the added wet well venting capability and the water addition and water management strategies will be implemented starting in 2016 through the agreed-to schedule. And then we expect to, as mentioned before, comply with the mitigating strategies rulemaking along with the rest of the industry in the consolidated approach. The end of my comments. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Gunter.
I'd like to thank you for the invitation, and I'd open my comments today with an observance that yesterday Michael Marriott with Nuclear Information Resource Service passed away at his home in Maryland, surrounded by his loving family. I'm sure a number of you knew Michael, and certainly we in the public interest community are going to miss him. Our concern today turns to some examples of the Fukushima lessons that have been unlearned in the United States. Defense in depth is being whittled away and sacrificed to the U.S. nuclear industry's increasing fragile economics. I will focus on the example of the post-Fukushima regulatory treatment of containment and emergency planning components as it pertains to one specific biological hazard generated in a severe nuclear accident, radioactive iodine. Next slide, please. Quite simply, the pressure suppression containment system for the GE Mark I and Mark II boiling water reactor is too small to contain the dynamic energy of a severe accident. This inherent design flaw has been known since 1972, yet we continue to see piecemeal approaches and voluntary industry initiatives to allow operators the option to deliberately defeat the containment design function in hopes of saving it from permanent rupture during a severe accident. Fukushima demonstrated a 100% containment failure rate for the same containment venting system that is currently deployed on nearly one-third of the U.S. nuclear reactor fleet. Next slide, please. Radioactive iodine is one of the more manageable radioactive isotopes generated by a nuclear accident. It's a relatively short half-life of 8 days, constitutes a biological hazard for about 80 to 160 days. It can be effectively retained and contained along with other radioactive isotopes by state-of-the-art engineered radiation filters on hardened containment vents to reduce the uncontrolled radioactive releases to the environment and population exposures. Emergency planning can be enhanced by providing safe and effective doses of prophylactic potassium iodide, as is used in common table salt, pre-distributed in advance to saturate the thyroid gland, particularly in young children, for protection from radiogenic diseases of the thyroid. However, in the aftermath of the Fukushima catastrophe, the public interest community has witnessed both of these beneficial aspects for defense in depth dismantled and obstructed by the nuclear industry and the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Next slide, please. On January 9th, 2013, senior management for the NRC staff presented its broad-based consensus to recommend that the commission order the installation of external engineered radiation filters on sphere accident-capable hardened vents on the GE Mark I and Mark IIs. In the staff study judgment, using established regulatory practice and guidance, the use of filter vents when used in conjunction with containment spray and reactor cavity flooding, as already added by the NEI guidance at reactors in response to the September 11th attacks, represented a cost-beneficial and substantial safety improvement. The nuclear industry lobby and its champions in Congress vehemently opposed adding the filters to the containment vents, maximizing decontamination in the small containment by increased water spray and reactor cavity flooding was preferable and sufficient. However, the NRC staff focused their defense in depth concern without the benefit of the external filtration on the uncertainties regarding the effectiveness of internal decontamination in the extremely cramped containment that still needed analysis and provided performance requirements. In anticipation of the commission vote on adding filters in March 2013, UBS, the global Swiss banking giant that handles nuclear corporation finances, predicted, quote, "We increasingly believe that the NRC may not require these added precautions given the added stress this places on the incumbent portfolio, as well as the fragile state of affairs among existing units." UBS concluded that while not overwhelming, the additional cost would add insult to injury for an industry in difficult economic environment. The commission majority vote rejected its staff's recommendation for engineered filters and issued an order for just the containment vent and directed staff and industry to develop other nonspecific severe accident confinement strategies, such as the industry-favored adding and managing of more water and containment. The commission directed staff to pursue a proposed public rulemaking to solicit further stakeholder comments on radiation filtration and develop the performance requirements for what industry now describes as severe accident water addition and management. That proposed rulemaking, renamed containment protection release reduction, would never happen. There would be no public comment or independent expert opinion on the benefit of engineered filters, and as a result, as the NRC staff had described in its earlier concerns, no NRC or independent vetting of performance requirements on industry severe accident water addition. Next slide, please. In our view, the protection of the management, the protection of the American public from the GE containment design vulnerabilities is a least cost base case scenario in favor of industry's hands-off approach to its fragile economics. Next slide, please. In the meantime, the Japanese Reform Nuclear Regulation Authority essentially adopted the NRC staff recommendation for external engineered filters as a prerequisite for restart of the boiling water reactors there. By August 2015, Areva had announced delivery of its 14th filtered containment vent system for installation in Japanese reactors initiated by Hitachi GE. TEPCO has since completed installation of redundant filtration units on its Kazuwazaki Kirawa nuclear power plant that are both above grade for flood qualification and redundantly below grade for seismically qualified backup systems. Next slide. Moreover, it's our concern that even an NRC order doesn't constitute what the public might think an order should. The NRC can, in fact, the order can be undone with a request for an extension to comply without a single public meeting. Ironically, New Jersey's Oyster Creek Nuclear Station, the first Mark I in the world, Fukushima's prototype, as well as the first unit in line for compliance with the order, also received the first waiver from compliance following this summer's scheduled refueling outage and restart for fall 2016. The NRC staff waived Oyster Creek's compliance until after Exelon plans to permanently close the reactor on December 31st, 2019, none of Exelon's pro-offered compensatory actions addressed the post-fuel damage requirement in the order. Based on this precedent, other industry waiver requests are now anticipated. Next slide, please. Though recommended by the Kemeny Commission in October 1979, the NRC would not propose optional voluntary stockpiling of potassium iodide within the 10-mile EPZ until 2001. Next slide, please. As of today, 25 of 34 eligible states participating in NRC's voluntary initiative for voucher distribution within the 10-mile EPZ. However, according to public health surveys, the current KI emergency plan is ineffective, as only 5.3% of residents respond to the voluntary pickup. Next slide, please. The American Thyroid Association has repeatedly appealed to the NRC to expand the distribution of KI by direct delivery to all residents within 50 miles and wider stockpiling out to 200 miles. Next slide, please. Moreover, the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission required that by December 31st, 2015, pre-distribution of KI by direct delivery to every resident within the 6-mile primary evacuation zone around Canadian nuclear power plants would be completed. The Canadians have further expanded public awareness for KI out to 31 miles from their nuclear power stations. Next slide, please. The chief lesson from Fukushima for us, according to Japan's National Diet's Fukushima Dai-ichi Nuclear Accident Independent Investigation Committee, determined that the catastrophe was profoundly man-made and the result of regulatory capture. The combination of willful negligence, the collusion of government, regulator, industry to advance corporate production and financial agendas over public safety and regulatory deferral of enforceable standards to voluntary industry initiatives adds up to a recipe for the next disaster. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll begin the questioning this morning with Commissioner Barron.
Well, thank you all for being here. I appreciate your comments. In the last few years, five U.S. reactors have permanently shut down, and three more have announced plans to close. Licensees are actively considering shutting down an additional four units at Clinton, Quad Cities, and Fort Calhoun in the near term. I want to get the panel's thoughts about how these announcements will affect compliance with post-Fukushima safety requirements. Paul noted just a couple minutes ago that Oyster Creek, which plans to shut down in 2019, was granted an extension on implementing phase one of the order requiring severe accident capable hardened vents. Essentially, Oyster Creek got an exemption from the requirement to install wet well vent by fall of this year. Recently, Entergy submitted a request for an extension for Fitzpatrick to comply with the mitigating strategies and spent fuel pool instrumentation orders. Paul, let me start with you. If NRC gets similar requests for other plants in the future related to vents or another requirement, how do you think NRC should evaluate such a request?
Well, thank you for that. It's our concern that the NRC has to draw a line in terms of what an order means. And, clearly in the case of Oyster Creek, when the order was issued, the agency had provided Exelon with an opportunity to address the NRC's calendar dates, schedules for compliance, and then they took a pass on that. And it wasn't until later that they announced that they would seek an extension to comply on a schedule change that, disingenuously puts the takes them through an exemption process without any public oversight or transparency. And I think that, clearly in terms of the severity of the Fukushima disaster and its consequences, we're asking the NRC to hold the line on the orders that it issues and its schedule. And I think that's reasonable.
Let me explore that a little bit with you. So what do you think the standard should be in a situation like that? How do we weigh, or how do you think NRC should weigh the length of time the plant will be open and would be benefiting from a safety enhancement with the benefit of the safety enhancement? How do we weigh that? If the plant would close a month or 6 months or a year after a particular safety enhancement came online, how do you think we should weigh that?
I think one clear guideline would be no more refueling cycles I mean, we're right now we're looking at Oyster Creek, you know, going through one plus fuel cycles. And I don't think that it's reasonable to extend that kind of undue risk to public health and safety.
I'm interested in what the rest of the panel thinks about this issue. Tony or Randy, do you have thoughts about how NRC should approach extension or exemption requests related to post-Fukushima requirements at plants that are shutting down?
On a case-by-case basis.
Anything beyond that? I mean, so I think that's basically the approach right now. Yeah. The NRC staff's taking a case-by-case look at it.
I think that's appropriate because the circumstances are different for each site. You have an exemption process specifically to deal with case-by-case things like that, so I would exercise that process.
Do you think there are any, and I want to hear Randy's thoughts on this too, if he has any, are there key factors you think the NRC staff should be looking at when they're evaluating these on a case-by-case basis?
I think you have to look at the magnitude of risk and the time exposure.
In time exposure, you mean how long the plant will be operating?
Yep. Okay.
Ken? I didn't mean to exclude you.
I just wanted to add to Tony's comment. So all forms of electrical generation have some form of hazard associated with them. So if we assume Oyster Creek's replaced by a coal burner or another generation of like gas unit, carbon's produced. There are health effects from other sources of electrical generation, and you can do trade-offs with period of time and exposure to the hazard and other health effects from other forms of generation.
To address your question, I think you do have to consider the time constant here and the total time constant of the activity that was being requested. So if you look at the end date for this particular application of the 109 order, the end date was summer of 18, which had already been evaluated from a risk standpoint. So the extension time then has to be looked at. The consequences of the event and also the mitigating actions that were put in place and what were there, those all have to be factored in on a case-by-case basis, as Tony mentioned, along with the risk impact and the other economics that Ken had mentioned, as well as other hazards that are dominant by having a plant shut down or have something prematurely done like that.
Any closing thoughts from any of you on this topic? I'll ask the staff about this too, and we'll get their thoughts. Randy and Ken both discussed the development of accident-tolerant fuel. And this question for both or either of you, when do you think it's likely that these technologies would be ready for NRC review?
There's been discussions of, well, accident-tolerant fuel is a wide area. There are several different systems that are being discussed. All have pros and cons, difficulties in manufacture. These things haven't been done. All those caveats in place. It looks like early 2020s, so sometime in that time frame, test fuel assemblies or test pins would be available for insertion. Currently, that's the thought. Prior review would be submitting something to the NRC in the 18s or 19s, I would assume.
And do you anticipate any challenges for NRC in being prepared to review those?
Yes.
And talk a little bit about that, please.
Well, with all new technology, you know, this is a system, and one of the things I missed in my notes was it's a cradle-to-grave type of thing. Which is one of the reasons why molybdenum with coated zircaloy is a preferred system. Every time you change something, you'll move other dynamics. So you'll have other chemistry effects if you use different materials. Most people don't know that silicon carbide is actually soluble in water. Only a little bit, but still soluble, and what are those long-term impacts? So I think, you know, careful review will be required, and it's first-of-a-kind technology, which always creates some challenges for the regulatory environment. Hmm.
Do you think, and I know this is a little bit of prognostication, but would you anticipate that the first technologies we received here for review would be ones where you didn't have a change in chemistry or not a very significant change, or you not necessarily coming in that order?
As a researcher, I would hope that that regulatory thoughts didn't play too significantly in the technology chosen, but in reality, it does. So again, the molybdenum concept that's coated with zircaloy on both sides is a very positive one because it doesn't change those chemistry. It changes things less. And so one of those things, I think, when making a submittal, one of the considerations would be things that don't change the regulatory regime as much.
Randy, do you have any thoughts you want to add? Okay.
Commissioner Barrett, can I just add one more comment to your original question?
Sure.
I think it's important to recognize that an order modifies the operating license of these nuclear facilities, and that's a critical legal question, and it needs to be redressed through the legal process. So I think it's disingenuous to essentially avoid an order on a schedule change when, in fact, there is this obligation to meet the modified operating license.
Thanks. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Oh, thank you. Commissioner Barron covered an area I was interested in beginning with respect to the process that Mr. Gunter and others spoke to. I'm going to turn first to Mr. Canavan. I was interested in your comment and with regard to the contribution to radioactive release from the Fukushima accident. It was mostly Unit 2. And yet, I think what I understood you to say, Unit 2, relatively speaking, was less, if that's the right way to say it, less damaged or more integral. Could you just refresh me as to what the reason or what the understanding of that is, why that was?
I can walk you through some of the statuses very quickly, and again, no one has seen where the cores are, so this is all based on modeling and simulation, although to date, we're fairly confident in that simulation. Yeah. Unit 1, 1F1, lost core cooling very early. Mm-hmm. It's expected that about 10 to 12 hours into the accident, the melted core exited the vessel and is in the containment. Mm-hmm. Unit 3 similarly lost cooling late, but also for a sustained period of time. And again, some of the core is expected to be exited the vessel. However, for Unit 2, while again, this is all based on modeling, it would appear that the core would be in the vessel according to modeling. So it hasn't exited the vessel. Yet the timing and releases correspond with the largest radiological contamination, actually line up with that NNSA diagram that we all see. Largely, that's probably a result of extremely high core temperatures at the same time that drywall head lift occurred. So it's suspected that pressure in the containment, the hardened vent or the vents were not utilized at that time. Containment exceeded twice design. At that point, the drywall bolt stretched and the head relieved. Fission mm-hmm. products were relieved out the top of the structure, and that resulted in the contamination that we see. Combined with adverse weather conditions, it was raining.
Okay, thanks. Let me stick with you for a moment. Can you tell me a little bit more about the international benchmarking efforts and analysis activities that are going on with respect to the evaluation of the accident and what the nature of your participation for EPRI is on that?
Well, various organizations have done their own simulations using their own codes or other predictive methodologies, and EPRI participates through a number of forums, IAEA and some others, WG Risk in Europe, to discuss some of the outcomes of our analysis and compare and contrast. I think largely benchmarking efforts have been between, in the U.S., between the MAP code, which is an EPRI-owned severe accident code, and MELCOR, which is a U.S. DOE code. And those comparisons have been the subject of much effort and a lot of work. The international ones are really in their earlier stages
okay.
comparison.
All right, thanks. Johnny, I want to turn to you with respect to a couple issues with respect to the rulemaking effort that's underway. One of the things you noted, and I appreciate a little more granularity on this, is that you noted that you believe that the change control process with respect to, I think, the flex equipment or the beyond design basis strategies ought to be different. And I'd like to explain that a little more and compare that to for what I'll call the normal process, or what I call the norm, or what I can at least conceive of as the norm for operating reactors.
So for operating reactors, we have 10 CFR 5059, changes, tests, and experiments. Mm-hmm. You do a licensing check, basically, of the change or experiment you're making to determine if you have an unreviewed safety question.
Right.
Okay, there's criteria established in that rule. If you exceed the criteria, you come in for a license amendment. You ask for prior NRC approval before you implement the change. So that's what we do for the traditional design basis material. This is beyond design basis, so I think it's wrong to apply the same test to it. We think it should be something less than that. One idea was to say that the licensee evaluate the change, keep the record at the plant for inspection, such that when the NRC is conducting its baseline inspections, they can see whatever changes were made and whether they agree with the evaluation that there's still compliance with the rule. So it's very, very simple. There is no submittal made. It's just an evaluation that the plant staff does, licensee does, that's available for inspection. So that's kind of the other end of the spectrum. Is there a 5059 light-like process? I haven't heard of one yet. But I think for the kind of safety significance of these beyond design basis things, I think the approach where the licensee evaluates it and keeps the record for inspection is probably appropriate for this category.
Okay, and how, what is it that assures that maintain the fidelity of, in effect, the equipment or processes that were intended to implement through design basis?
Yeah, there's
because 5059, the same way, there's not a requirement 5059 that those, the process is 5059, the licensee does the evaluation. We know, I think, historically on close calls, they may be submitted to the NRC, even though that 5059 doesn't require that. But
I think that would still be in place for the areas where the interfaces with the safety systems, where the connections are made for the flex equipment, those would still be subject to 5059. But for all the rest of those things on the mitigation strategies, I think the licensee can evaluate that and keep a record of the change. We could submit, like we do for FSAR updates, 5071E, a record of those changes that were done and a short basis for why we think we're still in compliance, and that could be subject to inspection. So it should be a much less burdensome process for this.
Okay, Mr. Gundy, do you have any thoughts on that?
I think there's a real foggy situation here between license amendments and 10C for 5059 that we would appreciate more clarity by providing public withstanding.
One other thing, Tony, I want to talk about is the process, and had some discussions in some of my plant visits on this, and it's a question of the credit for use of flex equipment and other applications. And I know there have been a couple instances where it hadn't worked out. Well, it isn't the credit, but in the terms of the application invocation of the flex equipment, if you will, hasn't worked out as well as probably intended or thought. So I would appreciate it. So give me an idea of what it is that we're crediting, or how would that work? And again, in ensuring that sort of overall the fidelity in terms of undertaking activities at the plant.
Right. So I put them in two categories. The first category is what you can use the flex equipment for, I'd say in a qualitative way, mm-hmm. not modeling it in the PRA or anything like that. So it's just kind of another layer of defense in depth that you could apply to whatever the situation is. Two white papers we've submitted to the staff for consideration and discussion are notices of enforcement discretion and the significance determination process. That's the more shorter term applications. Longer term, I think there is discussions already underway on how you would model flex in the PRA. We believe that's going to take longer to work through to determine what's acceptable for that. But in the interim, we think we can use a lot of these qualitative applications. They're not like Regulatory Guide 1174, where it's an amendment you submit, and none of that. This is using flex equipment. I think one of the cases you may have heard of, Chairman, is it in a specific licensee used it as defense in depth during an outage using the flex equipment. I think that's a terrific application. It allows the plant staff to get the equipment out in the field, hook it up, get familiar with it, in addition to the normal surveillance it's going to get. So the more familiarization you can get with equipment that's not going to be used very often, I think is a win-win. And for the staff and the residents and the regions to see the licensee utilize that equipment is a good thing.
Okay, thanks. And my last question, Mr. Bunt, regarding the mitigation strategy, you said that for the U.S. BWR fleet is expected to be materially complete by the end of 2016. So for, give me some flavor for BWR Mark 1s and 2s, what will be in place at the end of 2016?
I understand. What we will be in place is their procedures, their equipment, their connection points for those equipment. The thing that won't be in place is their enhancements to their wet well venting. The majority of these sites already have hardened wet well vents that they installed as part of their generic letter back in the 90s. They all have venting capabilities and procedural compliance on how to do that. So what wouldn't be done is the material or the equipment and the enhancements that are done under the 109 order, which would come in a later date.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Commissioner Sabinicki.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank all the presenters for being here today. My colleagues have covered a number of issues that I was interested in exploring. I think I'll begin by turning to the two questions that Chairman Burns asked, but I am having some difficulty in bringing the two concepts together. This is for Mr. Petrangelo. On the one hand, the chairman asked about change control, and these are my words, not yours, so I'm paraphrasing. Seems that the industry is setting an expectation that they would like to have some kind of graded regulatory treatment for change control on some of the mitigating strategies, measures, and equipment. But at the same time, then the chairman's next question was about perhaps crediting for the existence of some of these strategies and equipment. I know you mentioned that as further defense in depth, but it seems to me a reasonable person could hear that as, on the one hand, I want a lighter regulatory footprint, and on the other hand, I want to have some kind of underlying acknowledgement of this equipment for fundamental issues within the design basis. So, do you acknowledge that it could be heard that way? And if so, why is it not that you're advocating for?
I think you characterized it very, very well. I think we have a new rule that requires us to have these mitigation strategies in place with all this equipment backed up by the national response centers. We want to leverage that equipment to improve safety in certain situations during normal operations. So the lighter regulatory touch, I think, is for any changes in the mitigation strategies that the rule requires is, I think, appropriate for the beyond design basis part of the framework. But for the existing framework, we're just simply using the equipment as additional safety measures. So I don't see a conflict there myself, but I could understand how it could be construed that way.
Well, I suspect, and I can explore this with the NRC staff, but in some of the discussions you're having with them, I suspect that this is a core issue for them and that something that is going to be credited, although I don't like that term, maybe acknowledged in underlying or incorporated into underlying risk analyses, I think that it is likely that that will bring with it then a heavier regulatory treatment of whatever it is that you're crediting in other risk analysis. So I think that's going to, I think a lot of this resolution is going to turn on that question of how much is enough. And I think if it were that, you know, the equipment exists, don't get me wrong. I've been to a lot of plants. I've gone and look at it, and it's substantial, and it's physical, and you can go look at it. So I would understand a mindset that said, but it is here, and it would be usable and used in the event. But on the other hand, I know this sounds profoundly bureaucratic to say, but if it is credited in certain analyses, I think that will have to be a consideration in the regulatory treatment for change control and configuration management and other measures, knowing that it is beyond the design basis, and I understand that. But I think it gets a little murky, you know, once we start kind of having its not design basis, it's beyond design basis, and yet for some fundamental analysis of risk and hazard, we're going to credit its use and existence. I don't know. It's just tricky. It's uncharted territory, and that's really all I'm saying. I don't know the answer. I don't think the staff has made up its mind one way or another.
My only caution is don't make it harder to improve safety.
I think it's likely we can begin with that as a mutual objective for the NRC and the industry. Since we can't solve that one, I'll turn to Mr. Canavan. One of the things that we have an opportunity to do here is to do a validation of modeling and simulation. You had a slide, I think it was slide 4, that talks about embarking on a long-term in-depth technical understanding of the accident. A lot of our severe accident codes, and the chairman touched on this, are based on our expectation of the behavior of materials and systems. Does this long-term in-depth technical understanding, it seems to me this could be a multi-decade kind of research plan. Is it taking that kind of shape?
I think there's probably a multi-decade research plan. But there's also on-ramps and off-ramps to that that are sooner. So there have been some, I mentioned the technical evaluation project. If you go to the first report of that, which is publicly available, by the way, and you flip through the executive summary, you'll note that there's a simulation line that has what we think occurred during the event via simulation, and then there's the actual data points that are plotted. And when the data fits well, we know the conclusions that are modeled in the code are probably accurate. So we can, we have an understanding already of how to model and simulate. We have a very good match, actually, of the core dynamics that occurred. There are some things we don't know yet make educated guesses on based on the prevalence of data. For example, did a safety relief valve fail at a certain time? Did the head of the drywall lift to produce the consequence that we talked about earlier in radiological terms? So improving that understanding and refining those models and getting higher fidelity is part of the process. And as we learn more about Fukushima and as the Japanese do more and more work to get into the containments and then into the vessels and then eventually remove core debris, we will continually learn lessons that will continually refine those models. Are those models good enough now to do quite a bit of work? Yes, I believe so. I believe that they're substantially the containment and the core models are very good.
In terms of the core, if refinement comes through having physical data points, when does one begin to draw physical data out of Fukushima? And I'm reflecting on the fact that the Three Mile Island damage core ended up in Idaho. I did work out there, not on the core, but I had a chance to see detailed video surveys and things that were produced. And if you really want to validate a model, being able to have access to the physical thing is how you can know whether your models are at all close. When might the nuclear science and technology sector begin to draw any type of data like that from Fukushima? I guess that's what I mean by a multi-decadal thing. It will take a long time to ever be able to have access to that.
Well, since you're familiar with TMI, it took many, many years to get all the way into the core. And if you're familiar with TMI and you go to the site in the control room of Unit 2, there's actually a cutaway mock-up of the core. And you can see how it melted and relocated. It wasn't until they actually physically saw that and mapped it, they actually mapped it with a laser to get that model. And that provided a lot of insight. So I think it's a discovery process. We don't normally like those, but it is a discovery process where, as we move in, as radiation dies down, and we're able to get closer into the containment, and then eventually the cores, we'll learn more and more as we go. For example, we'll learn if the head relieved when we can inspect the head bolts. We'll learn more about whether a safety valve failed when we can see it. So for now, we strongly believe that the safety valve failed due to severe accident loads in Unit 2, but we're not positive. So we will have to, and I meant Unit 3, but we will eventually see. So I think it's a journey,
Well,
best answer.
I think that for the community of practitioners, there will be a tension dynamic between our desire to have access to data and information with the need of those who are doing the decommissioning will seek to have a timely decommissioning and proceeding along. However, an opportunity to inform our knowledge about something like this is rare, we hope, never again. So I think it would be deeply regrettable if we couldn't begin with a very conscious plan of what are those key opportunities to glean these kinds of accident insights, and if those can be somehow communicated to those who have the primary responsibility for decommissioning. Like I said, that will be in some tension. And so I think that I would hope that the international R&D community would come together to realize that there will be some very significant opportunities here, and if that should be communicated, I would hope, to those who are planning and executing the decommissioning at the site.
Yes, TEPCO is very interested in that, and they pursue capturing that information and sharing it as they go, as well as participating in the international communities that are trying to capture data and model and simulate.
Thank you. And Mr. Bunn, if I have a moment, I was just going to ask, you provided a fairly detailed status on a number of implementation activities, but specifically on severe accident hardened containment vent systems. What would be the key schedule uncertainty, or, if you will, the long pole in the tent, and completing those activities on the schedules currently projected? Sometimes it's design, sometimes it's procurement. Is there anything there that you would identify as having the greatest association with schedule uncertainty for completing those plant modifications as currently projected?
Thank you. The longest pole for half the plants is design. I believe the other half the plants are really modifying what they already have to some degree, so are going in an area going forward. Design is well underway. We're sharing the lessons learned from the early design plants to the later ones, so we
is
are...
Is it beneficial? It strikes me at the plants I've gone to that it's extremely plant-specific, and they have to look at the impact of the integrated system and things like that. So is there much benefit in sharing design lessons between the plants, or are they so plant-specific?
There is several elements that are good for the sharing, from the missile capability to some of the structural impacts for where people are putting their vents, to the procurement of radiation monitors or the indication systems. So we have periodic, every 2 weeks or every monthly, calls within the industry to share their issues or their concerns. But there is a lot of plant-specific design elements that go into when you run the codes for your particular design of your plant site, but to create the overarching guidance on how you would address some of the unknowns or some of the other areas within the design process, we're doing that collectively as a BWR fleet.
Okay, thank you. I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, I went over by a bit.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Austin Dorr.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you all for being here and for your presentations. Very helpful. I appreciate the questions of my colleagues, very thoughtful. I want to start out just maybe by reacting to a comment I think Mr. Petrangelo made. And I think you're talking about the use of flex equipment during an outage. Is that?
That's one example.
Yeah. So I just, every now and then there's something that resonates with me for the following reason. Early on, the S5W Westinghouse submarine reactor plants had an emergency cooling system. And that emergency cooling system was routinely used. The design of the system was to provide flow via natural circulation in the event of loss of all AC power. Yet that system was also used routinely when the plants were cooled down during an upkeep or refit period, and the operators got experience. I think looking at Pat Castleman back there, you're an S5W submarine, your first back in, yeah. So we use this a lot just during normal upkeep periods, and I think it enhanced the operator awareness of how the system operated. You actually operated the valves, you looked at the temperature indications. And I had to, over my 16 years in sea duty, I had to use a system once for real life casualty. And I know that I was glad to have had the actual routine operating experience of having used it under non-emergency situations before I was presented as engineer directing its use in a very critical situation. So I'm not sure what it's worth, but it's an analogy that I personally, from operating and not maintaining submarines, think that's a good thing to enhance operator awareness and familiarity with the system.
Yeah, just to add a little bit, I think the arena we're talking about here is compensatory measures for something that's going on in the plant. This equipment's all the same across the industry. We've got EPRI collecting data, failure data on the surveillances we're doing on this equipment so that we can later on start to model it in the PRAs with some actual data, not just on assumptions. And I think, you know, to your point, getting your hands on it, using it, hooking up is very, very positive thing. And I don't want to get hung up on the treatment. It's required by a rule. We have EPRI developed the preventive maintenance templates for these pieces of equipment. So we've already got a pretty good program in place for that. I don't see why it should be different to support comp measures in some of these other areas.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to say, Mr. Petrangelo here, on your slide 4 on flexing inspections, I think your last bullet, you indicated there's a concern with potential for growth in inspection scope without careful management oversight. Do you have any details or specifics there or things that are of concern?
Not at this point, Commissioner, just based on experience. And I think I used the maintenance rule example last time I was here that, you know, that we got a rule, we had 5 years to implement it, tremendous industry effort along with the NRC to get ready to implement it. And then when it went to the field for the baseline inspections, the average was 4 level 4 violations after all that preparation work. The concern is really based on there's a whole different set of people that's going to have to implement now and interpret the new rules and guidance, et cetera, that weren't engaged with the front end of this. We're keeping around this task force just to maintain that knowledge level. I know NRR has plans to do the same thing with all the lessons learned within JLD. So it's just a big effort. It's a new piece of the regulatory framework, subject to interpretation. So I don't have any specific examples for you at this point. It's just we want to make sure that we capture the operating experience and let all the other licensees in on it and share it with the NRC on a regular basis so the implementation's smooth.
Well, I encourage you that if there are issues that come up, that that be raised to our staff. Does anybody else want to comment on that? Okay. Mr. Canavan, let me ask on the EPRI experience here. I set the clock back to 2012 at this table. When Commissioner Svenicki and I are here, the number of Fukushima issues that had come out of SECI 110137, looking at the Tier 1, Tier 2, Tier 3, seismic were some of the hardest issues at that time. There was discussions 4 years ago at this table about concerns on being able to conduct the seismic hazard reevaluations based on lack of seismic human capital expertise. What can you say about how would you characterize the health and welfare of the seismic expert community at this point in time?
They are very tired. To be in all frankness, that's actually not that far from the truth. My staff, and I know the NRC staff, puts a lot of work into continuing to solve some of the more difficult seismic research issues. It's time-consuming. It's a process that tends to evolve. So, for example, we look at hazards. We determine that hazards may have increased in certain areas, but only in a certain part of the curve. They're high-frequency motion, so we go into a high-frequency motion testing program that's quite extensive and, you know, express delivery. So we're working very hard to get that research completed. The research gets completed. We understand the impacts on equipment very well, but then we start looking at structures, and the models originally built for analyzing structures don't handle high-frequency motions very well, so now there's another. So it's a discovery process that has continued till recently, and it's been since Fukushima that we've been looking. So I would say that the demand remains high, and we continue to work very hard on the next set of issues.
Do you think, as a result of Fukushima, and I'll also throw in there the Dominion Resource August of 2011 earthquake in Southern Virginia, do you think that in 2016 there is greater consensus on the approach for seismic than there was before Fukushima? Look at seismic hazards.
I think so. I think we're moving in the right direction, and I think we're getting better understanding about seismic motion. However, it is an evolving area. It continues to move. I'm going to answer a different question, if I might. which is what one of my worries is that we continue to analyze issue after issue, and we generally disposition those issues to an understanding of higher capacity or significant robustness of the structures. And there's a lot of resource spent in evaluating what seems to be a smaller hazard. Now, I know we need that understanding to understand our the risk from seismic events. However, there are other hazards as well. So we need to balance resources with what we with what we think the commensurate risk is with the hazard. And in seismic, we probably put a lot of resource in right now for a hazard that's sort of lower.
Okay.
Right. Or has been shown in past to be lower. I should be more clear.
Okay. Mr. Bunt, from the experience of the BWR owner group arena, has NRC kept up with promulgation of guidance in a time period to facilitate implementation of the various orders?
Yes, we've worked very diligently with the staff on getting guidance out and getting frequently asked questions for the BWR fleet. We've issued several guidance documents and position papers that support the order. We have had a lot of professional conversations, some candid discussions, and come up with a reasonable working element, realizing that where each one of the groups come from. And just recently, as part of the phase two work with the 109 order, issued a revision one that got endorsed and had a very concise and documented template for the implementation of that, that I believe is speeding up the NRC's review of that so that we'll get the evaluations in a timely manner to support our design elements.
Okay. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. I want to thank the panel again for their presentations and the discussion this morning. We'll take a brief break. We'll reconvene at about 10:25 and hear the staff presentations at that point. Okay, well, call our meeting back to order, and we'll now have a presentation from the NRC staff. We'll discuss progress on implementing Tier 1 recommendations and overview of the staff's assessment on some Tier 3 recommendations, as well as a status update on the remaining Tier 2 and 3 recommendations. And staff will also discuss plans for NRC oversight of post-Fukushima safety enhancements. And I'll turn over to Deputy Executive Director for Operations, Mike Johnson. Mike.
Thank you. Good morning, Chairman and Commissioners. We appreciate the opportunity to report to you on the status of our Fukushima lessons learned activities. As a result of the March 2011 accident at Fukushima, we began a race. And at that time, we recognized that it wasn't a sprint and it wasn't a solo activity or individual sport. It was really a long distance relay. And we anticipated that at times the terrain would be rough. We anticipated that sometimes we would see adverse weather. We knew fatigue would set in due to the length of the race and the struggle associated with it. We knew there'd be distractions and we'd need to persevere if we were gonna be successful. Well, 5 years into that race, and here we are, we've come quite a distance. We've made, the industry has made numerous safety improvements that have been implemented at the facilities. Plants are safer because they are better prepared to deal with extreme natural hazards, and they're better prepared for other design basis, beyond design basis events. And as a previous panel discussed, I think they're safer because their margin associated with being able to deal with design basis events. We've made substantial progress. The progress that we've made is really a testament to the dedicated and capable folks on the staff and in the industry. And through active stakeholder engagement, external stakeholder engagement, and engagement, for example, with the Advisory Committee on Reactor Safeguards, I would note we keep count. At this point, we've had over 250 public meetings, so we've had an active engagement with those stakeholders. We've also benefited greatly from our collaboration with our international partners in a variety of interactions. We've had active engagement in the International Atomic Energy Agency and through Nuclear Energy Agency activities as well. And so I would say we're on the final leg of the race, and the end is within sight. Most of the safety enhancements directed by the Commission will be realized by the end of 2016. Of course, we'll give you a detailed description of where we are in each of those individual enhancements. And so we've made great progress, but I want to emphasize that there's still work that remains, and we'll talk about that work that remains as well. And it remains that we need to be focused and provide leadership, both on the part of the NRC and the industry, in order to be ultimately successful. Slide two, please. Our approach in addressing the lessons learned from the accident has evolved substantially, I would say, from the issuance of the near-term task force report in 2011. For every box on this slide, starting with the near-term task force, we learned from the efforts that preceded it. When it was appropriate, we modified our actions based on new information and based on lessons that we learned from performing our activities. For example, the original hardened vent orders, with those orders, we expanded to address severe accident conditions and to acknowledge the importance of water addition and containment during those circumstances. Ultimately, we added 9 additional recommendations from the near-term task force report and expanded the scope of several others. In some instances, we combined issues, and in other instances, we looked at what was recommended, we did an evaluation, we considered actions that were planned or implemented based on Tier 1 and Tier 2 items, and we decided not to pursue additional action. And of course, at the end, the Commission put its in place, made a decision on each of those actions as we move forward, and we've been implementing those actions. We will continue to learn as we complete our post-Fukushima actions, and we'll continue to make changes, propose changes as appropriate as we go forward. Next slide, please. This slide is really intended to provide, on a single picture, if you will, the work that we've done and the work that remains as we move forward on implementing the near-term task force recommendations, again, as modified by the staff, approved by the Commission. Our focus today really is on the actions that remain to be closed. We're going to discuss the progress made thus far and the pathway, our pathway for closing those items. But I don't want to lose sight of the fact that a number of the items, many of the items on this slide, as indicated in blue, have already been closed. Next slide, please. And so I want to turn to the folks at the table, introduce them briefly, starting with Jack Davis, who is the director of the Japan Lessons Learned Division. And Jack will provide an update on the status of lessons learned activities, particularly the Tier 1 activities. Mohammed Shams, all the way to my right, is the chief of the Hazard Management Branch. He'll provide an overview of the status of flooding and seismic hazard reevaluations. Greg Bowman, who is the acting deputy director for the JLD, will discuss the status of Tier 2 and Tier 3 recommendations. And last but not least, Troy Pruitt, who was the director of the Division of Reactor Projects in Region 4, will discuss the regional activities and, in particular, transition to long-term oversight. And so with that, I'll turn to Jack.
Thanks, Mike. Good morning, Chairman and Commissioners. Happy to be here again to report out to you the status of where we're at with these activities since we last met several months back. As Mike said, we continue to be on or ahead of schedule on all the activities, and we have a clearly defined path forward for the remaining items that go beyond the 2016 timeframe. Can I have the next slide? Thank you. So starting at the top there, I'll run through some of the stats for you just so you know where we're at. As you heard from the industry for mitigation strategies, we're approaching 75% in compliance. We'll have the remainder coming due this year. And in fact, we've already started verification inspections on several of the facilities that Troy's going to talk to you in more detail to give you a flavor of the things we've been finding out there. The spent fuel pool instrumentation order, about 85% are in compliance now, and again, with the remainder due at the end of the year. And we're also doing the verification inspections of those in conjunction with the mitigation strategies and inspections. The hardened vents, you heard Randy talk about almost a third. We'll have phase one, which is the wet well vent, this year. We're expecting about 75% next year, and then the remainder by the 2018 backstop date. And likewise for phase two, they're coming in on a staggered schedule, but again, most plants will be in compliance with that order about a year ahead of the backstop date of 2019 that the commission set. With regard to the reevaluated seismic and flooding work, again, by design, this goes past the 2016 timeframe. We're making good progress in that area. Majority of the plants will have completed their mitigation strategies assessments, as we call them, by the end of this year. And again, Mohammed is going to go into a lot more detail, give you the breakout of some of the areas that we're having somewhat of a challenge with. On emergency staffing and communications, the assessments and upgrades are in place for most licensees, and again, the few that are remaining will be done by the end of the year. We see no problem with them making that that date. On rulemaking, we recently published the proposed rule for comment. We received a lot of comments. We're in the process of looking at those comments, trying to address those comments. We are on track to deliver the final rule to the commission by the end of the year. We don't see any problem with making that date. On the next slide, I'll talk a little bit more detail about some of the comments that we had. In 2015, we took the insights, as you had instructed us to do, on the Tier 1, and we started applying those to the Tier 2 and Tier 3 items, and we were able to adjust our schedules to get to an earlier disposition of those items. And following the Commission's approval, we've closed all Group 1 items now, and just recently closed Group 2. And again, we're on track to close the remaining Group 3 items by the end of this year. And again, Greg will provide you more information on that. So really what we have left with Fukushima now, where our real focus is the seismic, the flooding, the vent work. We're completing our safety evaluations for all of this work, so we have a durable record from a regulatory standpoint. And then, of course, we've been, over the last couple of months, perhaps even a year, transitioning some of the activities back to the line and, of course, transitioning to oversight. And I would mention, you know, you heard Tony talk about he's concerned about inspections. We've been doing a lot of lessons learned, a lot of knowledge management with the regions. They've been hand-in-hand with us throughout this process. So if I can have the next slide, please. So just a little bit of detail on some of the comments we got. We received about 20 comment letters, and these included hundreds of individual comments. Many of the comments are going to help us further improve the clarity of the rule and get a higher quality product that can get approved. The four common areas that I've shown here, it's really to give you a flavor of some of the comments that we're receiving, and also some of the ones that perhaps have a little bit of a stickiness to them that we have to take pause and think about before we move forward with. So starting with the loss of all AC power, there's a bit of a disagreement, I guess, between commenters on the concept of the loss of all AC power. In mitigation strategy, we talked about it in terms of you lost offsite power concurrently with losing your emergency diesel generators. But we allowed them to take credit for inverters, for motor control centers, and so on, as long as those items could be protected from the external hazards. The language that we had in the orders, we carried through to the rule. So some people have challenged us to say that, well, that's not a strict interpretation of the loss of all AC power, right? Because you're using inverters, you're really having from the DC buses and you're turning into AC. We feel that the strict interpretation of that we can still deal with. We still have contingencies for that where they have portable equipment that they can take readings from, and they have alternate means of powering these equipment if those particular centers weren't available. And again, as I said before, that we specifically looked to make sure that, for instance, if they had flooding and you were going to flood out your distribution center, well, that's not acceptable to us. So I think we can just clarify the rule language somewhat more, and I think we would be okay in that area. A multi-source term dose assessment, we received a comment from industry that the backfit justification that we had for that was not sufficiently developed to justify the backfit. We went back, we took a look at what they had provided to us, and we feel that the initial look, perhaps there's some validity to that concern. If that stands, if that conclusion is substantiated, then perhaps a voluntary regulatory approach may be appropriate, because we still feel that there's significant safety added by having these particular multi-source term assessments. We received regulatory commitments from all licensees back in 2014 that they were going to do this, so we don't really see an issue with relying on a different regulatory tool if we need to go the voluntary route. On reevaluated hazards, we received comments that the rule language could be improved to better reflect the means of how we're addressing reevaluated hazards, and then also to incorporate risk-informed approach for these hazards. We feel that we're very receptive, I guess, to the risk-informed approach. We've done risk-informed approaches with the mitigation strategies order, and really we believe that it's already there in the rule. We think it's just another way for them to be saying that what we're already currently allowing. Nevertheless, we think that maybe the best approach here would be to put it in the statements of consideration to have better clarification that risk-informed approaches would be acceptable way of dealing with some of the hazards. And then on the clarification points, we would just take those comments and put them into the rule language itself. With change control, and I heard a lot of discussion from the previous panel on change control, we received comments suggesting NRC should include some more rigor, some more specific requirements in the rule. Currently, we have it set, as you heard Tony talk about, that the plants can do an evaluation. They would keep that on site. It's certainly inspectable by the agency at any time it wants to look at those things. And we felt that that was the best way to deal with the beyond design basis nature, the fact that it's a very flexible approach, so that it's really at the highest level of the strategy that you're really concerned about, that they not change. And then the other things that they can change down below, if they follow their normal processes, would be acceptable to us. There certainly are pros and cons to putting more detail into the rule that say that here's some more explicit criteria to use, and we're going to have to go through that. We haven't even had a chance really yet to work this up the chain of leadership to get some different ideas about how we might do this. We have some options, and we're going to present those, and then we'll figure out how it goes before we owe you the rule at the end of the year. Finally, on implementation, it's another key area, I think, for consideration of the rule. We have a lot of moving parts right now, a lot of different schedules with things coming into compliance. So the more that we can anticipate that, and the more that we can design in, if you will, the flexibility in the rule, the better off we're going to be, where we can avoid unnecessary burden in the end of having people come in and asking for an exemption when we already know that they're going to be on a certain schedule. So we're trying to build that into the rule as well with the language. With that, I'll turn it over to my next speaker.
Thank you, Jack. Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners. It is my pleasure to be here today reporting on seismic and flooding and what we're doing in these activities. My first slide, I thought to put up a flow chart to describe the overall picture of how we're proceeding with flooding and seismic. It is more for the benefit of someone that might not be as familiar as the Commission is with this activity. Last year, the Commission directed the staff to develop an action plan to ensure that the mitigation strategies address both the timely completion of the 5054F letters and the assurance that the mitigation strategies address the reevaluated hazard. This slide provides the overview for that plan. The action plan consists of two parallel paths. One associated with ensuring that the mitigation strategies developed in response to Order EA 1249 can be implemented under the reevaluated hazard conditions. The other path is associated with completing the 5054F letters to identify opportunities for further safety margins. The NRC and the industry are proceeding aggressively along those both paths, developing the necessary guidance and completing the associated assessments. I would say that the NRC staff has clear, well-defined approaches for completing both actions. I also want to take an opportunity to indicate that as the Commission directed us in carrying out the 5054F letter assessments, we always seek opportunities to focus the scope on those plants that would benefit from the safety enhancements. For example, last year we rescreened the plants doing SPRAs, and the staff informed the industry that only 20 sites need to complete these detailed seismic probabilistic risk assessment. Also, with the revised guidance in flooding, we anticipate that fewer than 10 plants would need to do integrated assessments. Original count would more like 50 plants would be doing that. The remaining sites will either screen out from further evaluations or perform limited scope evaluations to complete the information request. Next slide, please. So getting to the specifics and the statistics of what we've done, what we can see on the slide is that the staff and industry have made substantial progress in completing the flooding and the seismic hazard re-evaluations. In the seismic areas, as we can see, all licensees completed the hazard re-evaluation, and the staff provided feedback on the adequacy of the re-evaluated hazards. Licensees with an increase in hazard completed an interim evaluation known as the expedited approach, and it's intended to ensure adequate seismic margin existed while the detailed risk assessments are underway. We've issued staff assessments for all central and eastern United States sites, and we are on schedule to issue the remaining three staff assessments for the western U.S. sites, and that should be completed by the end of this year. In the flooding review area, with the exception of two sites requiring assistance from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, all sites have submitted their re-evaluated flood hazard information, and the staff is providing feedback on the acceptability of that hazard. To date, we've issued 51 letters asserting the acceptability of the hazards submitted by the licensees. The remaining 10 sites needed additional time to implement the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers information or to finalize calculations or licensee-initiated site layout changes. The staff expects for the remaining 10 sites, we expect to provide feedback letters for the majority of them by the end of this year. There may be one off by in next year. We can also see on the slide at the bottom right corner that work remains in documenting the flood reviews and staff assessments. To date, we've issued only 15 staff assessments for 25% of the sites. And I should say that this was done by design as part of our recovery plan for the flooding reviews. Over the past 9 months, we have directed the staff's efforts to focus on issuing hazard letters in lieu of staff assessments to provide the licensees with the needed information to proceed with their mitigation strategies assessments. And as a result of this movement, the vast majority of licensees are now able to and are on track to complete their mitigation strategies assessments. In the coming months, we will shift our focus back to issuing the remaining staff assessment, and we will do so in an expedited manner. Next slide, please. As I indicated, we're proceeding down two parallel paths for both the seismic and flooding reviews. This slide captures the ongoing activities in the flooding review area to support both the mitigation strategies and the closure of the 5054F letter. In addition to the progress in the hazard, as I indicated on the previous slide, the staff and the industry have made significant strides in developing the guidance necessary to complete the remaining assessments. And the staff recently endorsed a revision to the industry's guidance for mitigation strategies, NEI 1206, in order to provide guidance to the licensees for performing the mitigation strategies assessments, or MSAs, at the re-evaluated hazard level. All licensees will perform this evaluation, and the majority of them will complete it by the end of 2016. In fact, Mr. Petrangelo indicated this morning that 50 of them will be completed by the end of this year. I should say that in last April, we've actually received the first submittals of the MSA, so licensees are not waiting to the end of the year. They've already been submitting it to us, and we're in the process of reviewing them right now. To support the 5054F letter, the other path, the industry submitted a revised integrated assessment guidance, also known as the Phase 1 guidance. As directed by the Commission, this guidance provides a graded approach for performing the integrated assessment, such that the integrated assessments are focused on those plants where there is the greatest opportunity for additional safety enhancements. This graded approach will enable most licensees to demonstrate an effective plant response to the reevaluated hazard by submitting a focused evaluation. The limited number of sites needing to submit integrated assessments will complete them by the end of 2018. In terms of endorsing the phase one guidance, the staff has issued a public document. It's a draft guidance to endorse this phase one guidance. The staff also met with the ACRS and discussed the guidance and received feedback a couple of weeks ago. After addressing the public comments and ACRS's, the staff will finalize its endorsement of the guidance and will inform the commission in June prior to implementation. Another guidance document that we've been working on is the so-called phase two guidance. That's the guidance on carrying out additional actions as necessary based on the integrated assessment results. We're progressing well on this guidance as well. We're on track to complete it in October and again inform the commission of its completion. Next slide, please. This slide outlines the steps in the seismic hazard reevaluation process to support, again, the two activities, mitigation strategies assessments and the 50-54 F flood. We're taking an approach that's similar to the flooding reevaluation approach. Again, in support of the 50-54 ladder closure, since we met with the commission last time, the staff has endorsed the industry's guidance for performing high-frequency and spent fuel pool confirmations, and the industry is proceeding to complete these confirmations on schedule. With respect to the mitigation strategies, again, similar to flooding, all licensees will complete this assessment to ensure that the strategies can be implemented under the reevaluated hazard. In January of this year, the staff endorsed Appendix H to NEI 1206, which provides guidance to most licensees on performing the strategies assessment. And as we've seen this morning on the chart that Mr. Pratanju presented, the majority of licensees will be done by the middle of next year, completing this assessment. I should indicate that a number of licensees are aiming to leverage insights from their probabilistic risk assessments into their mitigating strategies assessment. The guidance for those sites are under development. It has been a focused area for the staff and the industry over the past few months. NEI plans to submit this guidance to the staff in the third quarter of this year, and that's intended to support the schedule for the final mitigation of beyond design basis events rule. Also, in terms of phase two, the staff is it's also working on the seismic guidance in that area, and we plan to submit it to the commission along with the flooding guidance in October. With that, I'll turn the briefing over to Greg to talk about Tier 2 and Tier 3 recommendations.
Thank you, Mo. As we discussed at our last commission meeting in November, coming to resolution on the open Tier 2 and Tier 3 recommendations has been a high priority for the staff over the last year. We provided SECI 150137 to the commission back in October with proposals for resolving each open item. And our goal in developing that paper was to identify disposition plans for each open recommendation in a timely and efficient manner while ensuring a strong technical and regulatory basis exists for our ultimate disposition approach. As we discussed in SECI 150137, the majority of the open Tier 2 and Tier 3 recommendations were evaluations to determine if there's a need for specific regulatory action like issuance of an order or a 50-54 F letter, rather than a recommendation, there were evaluations to determine if there was a need to take regulatory action rather than a recommendation to actually take a regulatory action. So given that, our focus has been on completing those evaluations and identifying whether additional regulatory action is needed beyond what's already been done. When we briefed you on SECI 150137, we discussed that the recommendations fit into three groups. Group one recommendations were those that we believe could be closed. Group two recommendations were those where our initial assessment identified what we felt was a sufficient closure basis, but where we felt there'd be benefit to additional interaction with stakeholders before finalizing that assessment. And then the group three recommendations were those that we felt required additional evaluation or development before we were ready to provide the commission with our closure recommendation. As you know, the commission approved the staff's plans for the open Tier 2 and Tier 3 recommendations earlier this year, including the closure of the Group 1 recommendations. Since that time, we've completed our evaluation of the Group 2 recommendations, incorporating insights from our interactions with ACRS, the public, and the ongoing state-of-the-art reactor consequence analysis. We provided our final assessment to the commission on these recommendations at the end of March, and they're now closed. In the next few slides, I'll discuss our basis for closing the Group 2 recommendations, and then I'll provide a brief status update and next steps for the Group 3 recommendations. Before I do that, I did want to take a minute to highlight the fact that we completed an evaluation of the need to modify our potassium iodine distribution practices as part of SECI 150137, since that issue came up in the previous panel. As part of that evaluation, we considered the radiological impacts in Japan from the Fukushima accident, as documented in a number of recent studies. We ultimately concluded that insights from the accident did not call into question the KI distribution practices in the U.S., and so we recommended and the commission approved closure of that recommendation. Next slide, please. So this is the first Group 2 recommendation, and it came from ACRS. ACRS recommended that we assess the need to upgrade certain reactor and containment instrumentation such that it can survive the conditions that might exist during a beyond design basis event. In SECI 150137, we discussed that based on the results of our initial assessment, there would be only a small additional safety benefit from imposing new requirements in this area. The primary factors in that conclusion included insights from the mitigation of beyond design basis events rulemaking and post-Fukushima safety enhancements, which, in addition to providing new capabilities to prevent core damage, also help ensure continuity of important instrumentation from the onset of an event, at least until core damage begins. Our initial assessment also considered existing guidance for treatment of instrumentation that may be impacted by severe plant conditions. This guidance includes provisions for the use of alternate instrumentation if primary instrumentation becomes unavailable, treatment of instrumentation uncertainties that may exist due to environmental conditions, the use of computational aids when direct measurement of plant parameters can't be obtained, and actions to take if conditions in the plant degrade such that there is no reliable instrumentation. Our more recent interactions with ACRS and other stakeholders have further supported our initial assessment and led to our final assessment, which closed the recommendation. The primary change from the initial to final assessment was the addition of further discussion of the approaches the licensees would use in the event installed instrumentation is unavailable due to environmental conditions, including the use of analytical techniques. It also reflects recent developments associated with the severe accident management guidelines, including the submittal of SAMG-related commitment letters from power reactor licensees and the staff's progress in developing the oversight program for SAMGs. Our recent paper also notes that we'll continue with ongoing work to update guidance that could be used on a voluntary basis by the industry if they choose to make instrumentation enhancements. Next slide, please. The next Group 2 recommendation came from Near-Term Task Force Recommendation 5.2, and it involved an evaluation of the need for hardened vents on containments other than Mark 1s and Mark 2s. SECI 150137 provided a containment-by-containment initial assessment of this recommendation, along with plans to obtain input from external stakeholders and the ACRS before finalizing that assessment. Our initial assessment considered the substantial information that was available from pre-Fukushima studies on containment performance, such as the Containment Performance Improvement Program from the 1980s. We also consider that post-Fukushima Mitigating Strategies Order, EA 12049, includes requirements for maintenance of the containment function under extended loss of AC power conditions. This order applies to licensees of all containment types and addresses the primary objective of the initial Mark 1 and Mark 2 containment vent order, specifically to remove heat and pressure from the containment. For example, for Mark 3 containment types, compliance with the Mitigating Strategy Order requires licensees to put in place measures to remove heat from the containment, generally through repowering suppression pool cooling equipment using portable power supplies. Finally, insights from the draft containment protection and release reduction regulatory basis for Mark 1 and 2 containments supports the finding that any risk benefit resulting from enhanced venting capabilities for other containments would likely be orders of magnitude below the quantitative health objectives, meaning that we would not be able to justify such action as a cost-beneficial substantial safety benefit under the backfit rule. Since providing the commission with our initial assessment, we've enhanced that assessment based on interactions with the ACRS and the public, and we've also incorporated insights from the ongoing SORCA study for Sequoia, an ice condenser plant, and additional analyses we've done for Mark III containments. As with the previous recommendation, the work we've done since completing our initial assessment further supports the staff's initial conclusion that further regulatory action on this recommendation is not warranted. Next slide, please. The final Group 2 recommendation, Recommendation 6, came from the Near-Term Task Force, and it recommended that the staff evaluate the need for enhancements for control and mitigation of hydrogen inside containments and in adjacent structures based on insights from the accident. In evaluating this recommendation, we were able to take advantage of significant information available from previous studies, as well as from a recent international effort to study hydrogen control practices. As with the previous recommendation, the October SECI paper provided a containment-by-containment initial assessment of this recommendation, and we concluded that that additional study is unlikely to identify the need for further regulatory action. That conclusion was based in part on existing requirements in 10 CFR 5044 for containment hydrogen control, and the fact that the mitigating strategies order provides a layer of defense against core damage and the resulting hydrogen generation that didn't exist before the Fukushima accident. Our initial evaluation also considered a number of containment-specific factors. For example, in the case of Mark III and ice condenser containment types, compliance with the mitigating strategies order includes provisions for repowering hydrogen igniters from portable power supplies. The analyses we've done have shown that availability of the hydrogen igniters can significantly improve performance of the containment under severe accident conditions. Finally, as with the previous recommendation, studies completed for the containment performance and release reduction rulemaking show that imposition of additional requirements in this area beyond those already in place wouldn't be justified under the backfit rule. So we've enhanced our initial assessment based on interactions with ACRS and the public, and we've also incorporated insights from the ongoing SORCA analysis for Sequoia and some additional analyses for Mark III containments. As with the previous two recommendations, the work we've done since our October paper further supports the staff's initial assessment that this recommendation should be closed. Next slide, please. So in addition to our focus on the Group 2 recommendations, we've also been working on completing our evaluation of the Group 3 recommendations, which are listed on this slide. In our October SECI paper, we described a four-step screening process for evaluation of external hazards other than seismic and flooding. We're nearing the completion of a paper that will provide the Commission with the results of the second step of that process, which will identify a list of hazards that require additional review. We held a public meeting on that subject in early April, and we recently met with the ACRS full committee and subcommittee. We plan to provide our paper to the Commission at the end of this month, and then our overall assessment of that issue at the end of the year. We've also been working on developing an approach that can be used going forward to systematically assess new information related to external hazards. This project is related to near-term task force recommendation 2.2, although it's been expanded to include more than just seismic and flooding hazards as was originally envisioned. We've begun developing a proposal to address this recommendation, and we're planning to engage with stakeholders, including the public, the industry, other governmental organizations, and the ACRS in the coming months. Our approach for resolving this recommendation is due to the Commission at the end of this year. The final Group 3 recommendation involves an assessment of the need for real-time radiation monitoring in the emergency planning zones and on-site. We've been actively evaluating this recommendation since October, and we're on schedule to have the final assessment completed by the end of this year. So in summary, we're on track to complete our evaluation of all the Group 3 recommendations later this year, consistent with the initial plans we provided to the Commission. And with that, I'd like to thank the Commission first for the opportunity to brief you on this important activity and turn the presentation over to Tori to discuss oversight activities.
Thanks, Greg. Good morning, Chairman and Commissioners. Today I'll be discussing the region's role in oversight. The NRC staff conducted on-site audits to review technical issues and observe modifications to the plant. Following notification by a licensee that compliance has been achieved, the NRC staff will complete a safety evaluation to document its assessment of licensee's final integration plan for compliance. This safety evaluation will be used to provide regulatory assurance and support completion of the NRC inspection activities. TI-191 is being used to verify compliance. Staff from JLD, who are responsible for the safety evaluations, will be assisting the regions in the initial inspections. Additionally, headquarters staff may also assist in the inspections. Cross-regional teams are being utilized during the initial inspections in each region. The staff is using cross-regional panels along with established processes such as the significance determination process to disposition any performance issues identified with these inspections. A draft manual, Chapter 0609, Appendix O, is out for industry comment. In its current form, Appendix O would have a detailed risk evaluation performed if one of the three safety functions of core cooling, spent fuel pool cooling, or containment is unavailable for more than 72 hours. So what that'll do is kick you out to a phase three analysis. Next slide, please. Inspections will be scheduled shortly after the staff issues the safety evaluation for each plant. And just as a side note, that's about 4 to 6 months from the time we get this safety evaluation in-house. That gives us time to notify the licensees through traditional processes that we're planning an inspection activity. A pilot inspection was completed at Watts Bar in 2015. More recent inspections have been completed at North Anna, Robinson, and Cook. The majority of inspections conducted under TI 191 will be completed in 2017. Inspection issues to date have involved the adequacy of procedures for storing and testing flex equipment, calculations for room heat up following a loss of ventilation, and labels marking deployment locations or hall paths. All of the observations have either been minor or of very low safety significance or green. With more plants coming into compliance with the new requirements, inspection and oversight activities will increase from this point forward. The staff has developed a transition to oversight plan. The transition plan outlines roles and responsibilities and ongoing activities. The plan assures consistent implementation through engagement and alignment of management, for example, cross-regional panels and cross-regional participation and development of programmatic tools. The plan provides for enhanced knowledge transfer opportunities, for example, visits to sites and the response centers, training at regional counterpart meetings, and biweekly calls. And the plan also provides for development of knowledge management tools. Those involve training modules and the development of a SharePoint site to exchange knowledge items. Once all initial inspections have been completed, a longer-term inspection process will be developed using TI 191 as the basis in incorporating any lessons learned. Normal processes will be used for long-term oversight, such as the baseline inspection program under the reactor oversight process. The staff is currently conducting training and creating a conduit for sharing information among the regions and other NRC staff. We are also working with industry representatives to prepare for our on-site activities. A number of related activities are ongoing with long-term oversight. For example, the staff is developing the oversight program for the National Safer Response Centers using the in-vendor inspection program. Findings at the Safer Response Centers are expected to be dispositioned by issuing notices of nonconformance to the vendor overseeing the facility. The staff plans to develop the inspection approach for the hardened vent order and for any changes made to the mitigation strategies in response to the reevaluated flooding or seismic hazards. All licensees submitted commitment letters in 2015 to integrate severe accident management guidelines, or SAMGs, into emergency response procedures. The NRC staff will review the generic BWR and PWR SAMGs, implement the necessary training for staff, and revise inspection guidance. Changes to inspection guidance for site-specific SAMGs should be completed by December of 20. That's all my comments, Mike. I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks, Troy. Slide 19, please. So as you can see, we have achieved significant progress on implementing the safety enhancements as a result of the Fukushima accident. As outlined in the presentation, we're on track to ensure that the majority of those safety enhancements are in place by 2016, the end of 2016. Finishing with the point that I made at the start, our work's not done. Hopefully we've re-emphasized the importance that we push to the finish line, those activities in seismic and flooding, for example, that we do the transition to oversight, that we capture knowledge as we go forward. We're going to continue to monitor research activities and work that might be coming from other lessons learned activities as they happen in our country and around the world. We'll continue to engage effectively with stakeholders, as I think we have in the past, to solicit their input and consider them in our activities. We're going to continue to stay attuned to what happens in the international community and make adjustments, propose changes should they be warranted. So again, I think we've made good progress. We'll continue to stay engaged as we go forward as a result of the items that have been raised as a result of the lessons associated with the Fukushima lessons learned to ensure that we do, in fact, make plants safer. This concludes the staff's briefing, and we look forward to the questions that you may have.
Thank you, Mike. And we'll begin questioning with Commissioner Barron.
Well, thanks, everyone, for your work and for your presentations. One of the ongoing Tier 3 efforts is focused on developing a system for proactively evaluating new external hazard information on a routine basis. The goal is basically to actively seek out new scientific information that may deepen and refine our understanding of external hazards. I think it's an important effort, particularly in light of the expected impacts of climate change on some hazards like flooding, extreme temperatures, and drought. Greg provided a brief update on the status of this work, but I'd be interested in hearing a little bit more about where we are on that. I know you have all year to do it, but I'm curious about where we are.
Yeah, so we're in the sort of the early phases of developing the process, and we don't have internal alignment yet on how it would look. Our thoughts right now, we have a framework put together that would consist of essentially three components. The first being knowledge management, where we take the lessons learned from recommendation 2.1 and 2.3. We take the things we've learned about plant response to those hazards and incorporate them into, you know, sort of a memorialize them so we can use them going forward. The second component would be to sort of either establish new or reestablish, relationships with other federal agencies and with the industry that are involved in hazard assessment, things like groups like NOAA, the Army Corps of Engineers, EPRI, to support us going forward in that initiative. We would, as part of that, we would be looking to establish routine interactions with those organizations so that we can gain insights from the work they're doing. And then the third component of it would be, the sort of the implementation component of the process, where we take new hazard information in, we screen it against established criteria, we decide if further regulatory action is needed. So those are the three main components we're looking at. We do have some work left to do, sort of to align internally and then to get input from external stakeholders before we're ready to propose an approach to the commission.
Okay, well, thanks for that update. I think there are at least two approaches one could take to assessing external hazards. One is to do a periodic reevaluation after a set number of years. And another approach is what you all are looking at right now, which is there a way to do it on a more ongoing basis? It sounds like, based on the work you've done to date, that, well, I'll just ask this as a question. I mean, does it look like doing this on more of an ongoing basis is going to be a feasible thing to accomplish?
I think it is feasible. There are a number of challenges, though. I mean, I give one example, and then Mo might have additional examples. But the tools that we have available to us to assess hazards are not fully developed for all types of hazards. You heard that our work in seismic has benefited greatly from the fact that that was a very well-developed field. Flooding is not quite at the same place. And so going forward, we're going to be challenged, I believe, in the maturity of those tools and applying them going forward. So that'll be a challenge. I think it's feasible for us to develop an approach, but we want to make sure that approach is consistent, predictable, and not overly resource burdensome. Mm-hmm. So I think it's feasible. I think there are challenges that are going to require attention from the management team at the NRC.
Certainly. Well, I'm looking forward to seeing what you come up with over the next several months. I really appreciate that you're doing this work. I think it's important, and I think it's an interesting approach that's a little different than what people were originally suggesting here, but may have some real benefits of going that way. Mike, I also wanted to follow up on the discussion I had with the first panel about how announcements of plant shutdowns will affect compliance with post-Fukushima safety enhancements or requirements. On the first panel, we talked a little bit about the example of Oyster Creek essentially getting an exemption from the requirement to install wet well vent. I just mentioned Fitzpatrick recently submitted a couple of requests. Are we expecting to receive more exemption or extension requests of this type, either for the vent requirements or for other post-Fukushima requirements?
Thanks, Commissioner. I don't really know whether or to what extent we might get additional requests for relaxations. I would say certainly it's possible or feasible that we would, but we don't know of any today. But if I can just go forward then with that notion, one of the things that I want to point out as I was listening to the discussion in the previous panel is that for the majority of plants that we know about between now and 2018, the majority of those will be in compliance with the mitigating strategies order, for example, with the spent fuel pool instrumentation order. So those plants we know about. For plants that have to put in vents, hardened vents, those orders become effective those implementation dates are around 2018, 2019, which is when those plants would be shutting down. Mm-hmm. So we have a good understanding about the folks who are sort of on the plate, if you will, with respect to their intentions. And I think because we, for example, have built into the mitigating strategies rulemaking actually provisions for plants and decommissioning, once that rule is effective, we'll be in a stable place from a regulatory perspective dealing with those should they happen after that fact.
Right now, in the absence of having gone final on the mitigating strategies rule, can you talk to us a little bit about how the staff evaluates these exemption or extension requests?
Sure, Commissioner. If I could, I'm going to ask Jack to do most of that discussion. I do want to point out that, as you are aware, because you made this point actually in the earlier panel, it is a case-by-case evaluation. When we look at what is requested, it's often plant-specific. When we look at what we would consider, in fact, it is plant-specific, case-specific. And so because plants give us lots of leeway, typically, for those requests, we have enough time to look at what their rationale is, what their justification is, what compensatory things they might be doing, and that enables us to be very thoughtful and deliberate about making a decision. So, Jack, do you want to add to that?
Sure. Thanks, Mike. Yeah, and I think it's important to point out, too, that there's really, we've had two sets, if you will, of different kind of exemptions. For the mitigation strategy order, the majority of those, all of them, and I take back, all of them have been just to extend some time for them to complete it, still meeting the backstop date. The few that go beyond there are related to the plant shutting down, right? So for the, you mentioned Oyster Creek, I think it's important to recognize we look at those very seriously. We expect them to have compensatory measures in place to essentially accomplish the same thing they would have accomplished with the order. In Oyster Creek's case in particular, the wet well vent that they currently have, they still have to be able to operate those valves, open and close that vent without any motive force, without any AC power. So they had to have additional commitments put in place to have like nitrogen bottles, for instance. Those questions that we asked of them were all done in the public's eye. So the REIs that went out, their responses that came back were all public, publicly available. So we take it very serious. We do it on a one-off basis, and we have to make some engineering judgment as to, as Mike said, they're shutting down right around the time that the plant would have to be in compliance anyway. Does it really make sense to have them do that upgrade, or is it better to go with a compensatory measure?
Mm-hmm. And some of these requirements, including the vent requirement, were determined by the commission to be necessary for adequate protection of public health and safety. How does that effect play into the staff's evaluation of an extension or exemption request?
Well, so this is another one I'll start, and then if you guys want to join in, please do. So even at the time when the orders were effective, adequate protection basis, we recognized that there would be time necessary for licensees to come into compliance with those because they needed to do designs, if you will, or purchase equipment, do training, and all of those things. So we always recognized that there would be some amount of time needed. Relaxation requests are adjusting that period of time based on what they might encounter on a plant-specific basis. And so we think it's reasonable, actually, if it can be justified to grant those adjustments. So we're not determining whether or not they come into compliance. We're determining how long it takes. And as someone mentioned, I think, on the earlier panel, we'd be looking at, for, among other things, the risk and the exposure period, compensatory actions, and a number of things that we've considered in granting those.
Yeah, I would just add, Commissioner, that for, in the case of Oyster Creek, they still have to comply with the order just because we extended the time, right? So let's say they shut down, then they need to come in with a recension request, and we need to evaluate that to determine whether we would allow that to occur. In other plants similar to that, if they're shut down, they still have a component, right, that they'd have to protect, and that's the spent fuel pool. So it's not just that we're allowing them to not have to comply with the order, it's the timing of when they would comply with it. And we look at that on a case-by-case basis.
Well, and I don't want to spend a lot of time on the kind of semantic element of it, but you know, if we have a plant, Oyster Creek, just take as an example, a plant that's planned to shut down in a certain year, you know, 2019, and they get an extension on the wet well requirement until after the point they're shut down, you know, whether we call that an extension or we call it an exemption, I mean, practically speaking, it's going to be the same thing, right? I mean, they're going to have shut down by that point. I don't think anyone thinks at that point we're going to require them to put in a wet well after the plant shut down, right? I mean, it's
But you wouldn't need it at that point either, right?
Right, but I mean,
you'd still have,
kind of
you'd still have
point,
other
right?
components
for all
of...
For practical purposes, the extension is an exemption. It's saying that for this plant shutting down in a few years, you don't need to do a wet well vent.
If they chose to stay in operation, they would have to,
well,
be required,
point.
Right?
If the announcement turned out not to
right.
be effectuated, then that...
And then there's other components, though, that I think is the key point. Like, for instance, on the mitigation strategy and so on, they still have certain pieces of the order that they would still have to comply with, even though they're in a shutdown state, because they still have fuel on site. So it's not a complete... Again, that's why it has to be looked at, and they have to ask for recension or relaxation of certain components.
I'm a little over on time, but I just want to ask one thing. You know, came up as a little bit, I think, maybe on the first panel. If additional requests for an exemption or extension or relaxation, however we're talking about it, are submitted for other plants that are shutting down, will the staff consider seeking public comment on those?
So we don't, as you well know, as a part of that process, seek public comment. I would hasten to add that we've provided, and I try to illustrate the high level of stakeholder interaction that we've had from the time the orders were issued, from the time we were crafting guidance for how those orders would be implemented, through interactions that we've had with licensees as we've tweaked guidance based on lessons learned. And in fact, when we issue an RAI, those are publicly available. So there's good public visibility. There's not a formal way or in our process today by which we would go beyond that. There is a 2206 process that could be used for, by individuals who want to request action of the agency. We've seen that used in a number of instances and would encourage folks to continue to use that if they see fit.
Well, I'll wrap up. These are pretty significant decisions, and I would imagine that for many of them, there'd be pretty significant stakeholder interest. Even if we're not required to seek public comment, even if we haven't done so as a matter of practice in the past, is there any reason we shouldn't think about doing that going forward in cases of significant exemptions that would have significant stakeholder interest?
So I would just say in response to your question that we look to try to provide as much visibility as we can to the process. There are downsides. There are concerns that we would have by engaging in sort of a protracted interaction as a part of the decision process on some of these actions. So I personally, I'm comfortable with where we are. We could make sure through additional actions that we provide greater visibility if there were a concern that that's not the case.
Okay. Well, it's something to think about. We can talk about it down the road. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Thank you. One of the questions I would have is, and we talk about the first panel and as well as in the staff presentations, talk about ongoing engagement in the international community in terms of research, other types of activities are ongoing that contributed to further understanding of the Fukushima Dai-ichi accident, and as well as strategies to basically respond to it or to prevent or mitigate such actions. What are there particular deliverables, I would say, over the next few years we're looking at? Obviously, you know, I think Commissioner Siminicki talked in the discussion had on things like looking at some of the research on the fuel will obviously of necessity have to extend out a number of years. But are there particular deliverables we're looking for from IAEA or from the NEA or even bilaterally that might be inform us? We need to call on. Thanks.
Thank
Just
you.
Identify yourself for the record. And
Richard Lee from Office of Research. First is that I want to say the Melco code is an NRC code. Mm-hmm. It's not a DOE code. In terms of international efforts, the NEA just finished what Steve Weiss was participating in, the so-called, I have to read it, the Senior Expert Group on Safety Research Opportunity Post-Fukushima. The report will be coming out sometime in June. And they have identified two issues that in the near term, between 3 to 4 years, that they will look into, that will have a bearing on how to advise the government of Japan on the forensic. Those two activities has to do with the study the fuel debris using simulated debris and analysis. That is to help them, how do you develop tools for decommissioning? That will be useful for them, because when we do the analysis, the predictions of the fuel behavior is different, but when it cools down, it's completely different. It's a very difficult material to cut, as we have learned from TMI. Another one has to do with, the second activity has to do with getting rid of the contaminated water in the buildings, especially the turbine buildings, in all the three units, so they can stage the recovery, that the staff can work in a reasonable dose environment. So those two activities are proposed for the next 3 to 5 years. During that period, they will also try to, fine-tune what type of information that during the commission that the TEPCO can look for that can help us to validate our civil accident analysis code worldwide. So those are the two activities near term that NEA will propose by the regulatory agency from Japan.
Okay.
Another thing is that the US DOE also established a bilateral so-called civilian nuclear working group that we do track. And one of the activities has to establish an international framework for doing the forensic and just like the TMI international efforts.
Okay, thanks very much. That's helpful. One of the other things I'll ask with respect to international evaluations, I think it was last year, I think around the time of the general conference at the IAEA, the IAEA's report on the accident was issued. I think we had done at least a survey on it with respect to comparability, or whether, I think that whether there's a match in terms of actions the staff or at least the commission had looked at. Is there anything more you would want to say on that in terms of where we are? I don't know if in terms of any further look with respect to that or insights we've had from that report.
So we have completed our evaluation of the report, and we did not identify any gaps or any areas where we felt additional regulatory action was warranted based on insights from the report. I think, as you know, we had representatives from the NRC participating on the working groups that developed the report itself. So I think we were pretty well informed on what the report was going to say, and we had things pretty well captured when the report ultimately came out.
Okay. And Greg, while I got you there, with respect to this is the question I think Commissioner Barron touched upon about this, trying to create a framework for ongoing evaluation of hazards and natural hazards versus a periodic. What do we know about in terms of other regulatory bodies? What they do is, my guess may be that they have gone, given their other framework for licensing and oversight, to this periodic review or whatever.
So I don't know if where we are in the process, we've had a chance to gain insights from what the international community does, but I think it's a very fair point that other regulatory bodies have extensive experience in doing PSRs, for example, and we can gain insights from that as we move forward and develop our process. So that's a very fair point, I think.
Okay, it's an interesting because on the one hand, what I've also heard in terms of what some of them like about our process is the notion of the backfit experience and use of the backfit rule, which they may not necessarily be able to apply during the 10-year, for example, the 10-year period or the 5-year period.
And I guess the one thing I would point out is we develop the process for evaluation of other hazards. One of the things we're thinking is, we're thinking it might not be a ongoing review, a standalone ongoing review, but an ongoing review plus a periodic look at what we've compiled over the last X number of years, so we can see if cumulatively things have changed. So it's more than just a continuum. It's a points in the process where we look.
That's correct. Points in the process. Okay.
Yes.
Well, I think that's going to be interesting. I know that's a good issue to work on. One of the things I think Tony Petrangelo mentioned, and I think in the, some of the staff presentation as well, is this notion of, in effect, knowledge transfer and knowledge management, particularly as you get to a point where we've been in, let's say, the last 4 to 5 years, we've been particularly in an implementation of additional requirements or evaluations or the like. Those are now coming behind us, partly because the requirements are there, they need to be implemented, they will be implemented. What do you see as a, and reflecting on what I think I heard Tony say, what do you see as particular challenges in that transfer, and how do you intend to manage that?
So one of the things that we see as potentially a challenge is the group of folks that have been involved on the industry side have been what their Fukushima leads, if you will, and they have a group of people to do the Fukushima work, allowing the regular plant folks to keep their focus on safety. As they're transitioning back to the line and we're starting to get into inspections, those folks now have to pick up where the Fukushima guys left off, if you will. And so we're concerned that the knowledge there is not necessarily transferring perhaps as quickly as we would like. So we've already been in communications with industry, and we're talking about having a workshop later this year where we can kind of influx them, if you will, with understanding of what we know, because we've been in the trenches for quite a few years. We're doing the similar thing with the TI. After so many of TI, we're going to step back and take a look and say, okay, is there any lessons learned here? We're doing the same thing with the SEs. We're about 4 or 5 SEs in now, and we want to have a workshop and kind of work through what are some of the things that we're seeing on either side. We've been doing a lot of the work, again, as I mentioned before, with regions. We've been bringing them all along throughout this process. In fact, they've helped us a lot of times with the audit process. So they're already very, very familiar with what Fukushima is, what beyond design basis things are, and how we're going to inspect to those. So we feel pretty comfortable from that perspective. But again, there are some challenges with perhaps pockets as we move forward.
Okay. I mean, one of the things is looking, you know, looking back at the Three Mile Island accident is if we sit here today, and a few of us were around at the time, but is there something in reflecting on that says, do I wish I knew something better about what we did or what we are trying to get at about TMI today? Is there anything like that? Because you almost have, it seems to me, it may be worthwhile asking the question of ourselves, what are we still asking ourselves about in terms of TMI or understanding what we did at that time? And it, does that help inform how we might sort of capture that knowledge or capture?
I mean, certainly you saw from Mike's presentation that throughout this process, we've continually adjusted ourselves. We're in a continually learning mode. So as we learn new information, we say, perhaps what we originally thought might have been something of value is not as much, we adjust ourselves. And I think what Tony said and what Commissioner Ossendorf said about using this equipment in other capacities helps us to better understand and integrate it, if you will, and be ready for, if that time ever happened, it would be tragic, but if it ever happened, right, we'd be ready for it.
Okay. That last question I'll ask for
Tony. Also note that we have, in fact, reaching back over the years, captured sort of the higher level learnings, if you will, you know, preparing for the unknown, keeping a questioning attitude, those kinds of things. And those are captured actually in documents that we've written, published. They are already a part of our new reg. Knowledge capture series, if you will. We've done seminars for the staff. And when I look internationally, there have been similar sorts of activities. Those are a part of the very practical, detailed things that we've done, like writing essays, like doing handoffs along the way, the kinds of things that Jack and Troy talked about. So it's all of that stuff, I think, that we have to continue to do as we go forward.
Okay. My colleagues are indulging me. I was going to ask Troy, if you could just give some better detail in terms of what the temporary instruction focuses on. What are we asking our inspectors to go look at, or how to accomplish that? I think that would help those in the audience and me as well.
Sure. So the first thing is the safety evaluation that the staff prepares informs the inspection team as to what activities need to be looked at. And in practice, they go out, they discuss the strategies with the licensees' teams, they do field walkdowns, they'll watch simulations to make sure things can be hooked up, they do inventories, they have all the right equipment, they'll go out to the safer centers, but the on-site storage centers. In some cases, they observe testing and maintenance of the equipment. They compare the procedures back to the operator's use. They can take the procedures back to the technician's understanding of how the equipment operates and how it'll be deployed at a high level. They also look at emergency preparedness, communication links. I think that'll leave anything out. And most of my team leader, at least in Region 4, our team leaders went out with the audit teams on a few occasions to understand how the process was evolving. We're using the same core team to do all the inspections in Region 4, plus the resident inspector from each site. And our team leaders, before they start in Region 4, they go out and participate in the team inspections at the other sites. So John Matejczyk, who's one of my team leaders, was at Cook recently doing the inspection up there. And my other team leader, Ryan Alexander, will be at I forget which site, somewhere in Region 2 in a couple of weeks doing the same kind of thing.
Okay, thanks very much. Commissioner Savinik.
Well, thank you for your presentations. And my colleagues have asked some good questions, but I'll just make some comments and ask some questions in no particular order. But I guess I think I will start, Mike, with your context and kind of scene setter, a brief overview of how we got to where we are. Today, it's hard not to step back and reflect on that a little bit. I think you mentioned over 250 public meetings, if I jotted down the number correctly. I hesitate to tell this story because people who have smartphones, some in the audience are going to pull out their smartphones and do this as soon as I say it. But someone pointed out to me just yesterday that if you go to Google search, I have the Google app on my phone, but if you go to Google search and click on an image search, if you type in the search chain, public meeting Japan, so that's it. There's no nuclear, there's no Fukushima. An interesting thing comes up. It is almost entirely, at least the first couple of pages, are pictures of NRC commissioned public meetings. That might be maybe a commentary on other public meetings in Japan, but it's interesting to me that NRC, the fact that the very first picture, Commissioner Ostendorf, you and I are in it, it's a picture of this side of the table at a commission meeting. So not that I go Googling for things that image searches that yield images of me. There's people like Dave Skeen and others in there. But I think that's, now that may have to do, someone's going to email me later today about like Google search algorithms and the fact that it was me who searched and somehow that Google has a big portfolio on me and knows that I want to have the return be a picture of me, which I actually don't want. And that may all be true, but I think it has been quite an evolution and development. To this day, some have a very singular focus on the near-term task force, but the truth is we've had, at this point, many hundreds of NRC analysts and experts that have contributed to the NRC's regulatory response to the events in Fukushima over the course of the last number of years. Every stage in this process has posed a unique set of challenges, I think, for the NRC. Different challenges, some the same for the industry, but I'm more focused on what's the long pole in the tent for us. So I see this moment in time, as reflected in all of your presentations, is that really important inflection point where for years we have been in issue identification, exploration, analysis, coming up with whether or not there was a regulatory response, what that should be. And yes, the commission has shaped some of those. I think in some instances, I voted to adopt your recommendation. Others of my colleagues have not, and we ended up doing something different. At times, I've been part of a majority that indicated that although the staff considered many things, the appropriate regulatory response was something different. I think that's actually indicative not of a weakness in this process, but a strength in it. If the commission were merely here to pass through everything the staff developed, that would be a very different NRC than it is. The preponderance of things have been adopted, and many things didn't require the commission's endorsement at all. They fall under the delegated set of staff actions. Where things are going to fundamentally change the regulatory framework, the commission, of course, has been involved in those. And I think that a lot of good work has been done. It's interesting, we've had turnover on our side. When Jack came in, I thought, boy, we are asking this individual to come in. This is a difficult, awkward time for handoff. It had more to do with an important opportunity for your predecessor. But I want to credit you and many other individual contributors at NRC. And Jack, you did step in at an important time. But the challenge, or one of the key challenges I see now, is we've done all this identification and analysis, decisions have been made. And as a body of decision making, it reflects what we thought needed to be changed and areas where we thought we were well served by what we had. And I would remind people that the near-term task force in general felt that we were well served in terms of what we had. I don't think that they were calling for a fundamental sea change in NRC's regulatory philosophy. So we've had the intervening years, many, I think at this point, probably hundreds of thousands of hours of NRC staff analysis, and we've had a chance to shape that. But the truth for anyone who knows how NRC regulates is that now, as we move into compliance oversight and inspection of this body of decisions and then the manifestation of those decisions, it's going to come down to individual NRC inspectors, men and women in the field at these plants. A lot of the guidance and interpretation falls on their shoulders, and so I appreciate the acknowledgement for all of the gentlemen sitting on the other side of the table that you and other supervisors who report to you will play a very outsized role in making sure that there is coherence between you've been here at headquarters, except for Troy, appreciate your coming here today. You've been here to observe the development of the evolution of where we are very much up close. But we can't leave those people to kind of figure it out on the ground. And so I appreciate that the previous panel identified this as a challenge. I hear from you that we're well along in our thinking about it. But I think that will require a very active management and supervision. And so I think that's what the knowledge management comes down to, is this maybe not a capturing of knowledge, but making sure that there's a transfer of knowledge. And I appreciate, and again, I'm comforted that you're on top of that. I would turn to Mo on flooding, because people haven't asked you a whole lot about it. So I was at a U.S. nuclear power plant, doesn't matter which one, a few months ago, and they were giving a status on their compliance with Fukushima actions, as a lot of them do when I visit. And there was a discussion about their flooding assessment, and they said, we're still getting input on the XYZ dam. And I said, well, what state is it? And I don't happen to know. And more relevant, I said, and how far away from that? How far away from this plant is that dam? And it was over 900 miles away. Now, I don't know if you're a hydrologist. I'm not a hydrologist. But I think as a layperson, do you share my difficulty in wrapping my mind around how a dam failure 900 miles away, you know, impinges? I can create hypotheticals. I'm like any other creative person. My mind can try to figure. I realize a lot of these are river systems, and so we have to look at it that way. But then I tried to think about it and say, if that's the level of conservatism, perhaps it just reflects uncertainty and conservatism. It does affect how one would approach a periodic review of hazards, because the one way to handle the need to constantly relook at something is to look at it less frequently, but with an abundance of conservatism, because then the need to reanalyze it would need to be something that fell out entirely outside of that bubble. And I guess I'll let you speak to the 900-mile-away dam, but I do want to say this is the other. So I see two key challenges. One is the knowledge transfer. The other one is the fact that as we move forward, we really need to understand, as we've learned all along, that every action we've taken then has an effect on whether or not regulatory action is probably needed on other actions. And I don't want to draw I think in anything we look at in the mitigation of severe accidents, if you implement some measures, other measures are then less recommended than they otherwise would be. And I see the whole of the last 5-year journey as reflecting that idea? Is that Tier 1 made Tier 2 and Tier 3? I know that our most persistent critics might say, well, you know, time went by and NRC thinks that the public's forgotten about this, and that's why Tier 2 and Tier 3 are getting short shrift. I don't share that view at all, and I think it does require, you know, some study of all that we've done. But the fact that items in Tiers 2 and Tier 3 are less recommended on the basis of the Tier 1 actions, I think we knew that all along. And so this isn't something that happened accidentally 5 years later. Okay, Mo, I've got 1 minute. What about, why does that dam 900 miles away make a difference?
So I'm not a hydrologist. I'll start with that. I would say it's just the amount of water behind that dam. The fact that it is 900 miles away, it still has an impact on the site. I do share the view that it does lend itself to a certain perception of a level of conservatism that we are looking and we're implementing and calculating these hazards. And that goes without saying for flooding. Just the probabilistic risk assessment framework is not at hand yet, and it's several years away, if not, you know,
and
a decade.
I can't remember whether this site needed input from the Corps of Engineers. I know some sites need that. Can I just ask you quickly, do those sites get good transparency into that data? I had heard a couple of years ago that the Corps didn't want certain information underlying the inputs about flooding hazards to be shared with licensees or, frankly, anyone outside the government. It does raise, I'm the only non-lawyer on this commission or someone without a law degree, but it raises issues of, if I can convict you on evidence that I don't allow you to see, there's a kind of a, what I would call, as a non-lawyer, a due process issue there. Have we resolved that?
So Commissioner Andy Campbell is at the podium. He's been in the teeth of this this issue, and so if he can talk to
this
your question.
excuse me. This Commissioner Svinicki. I'm Andy Campbell. I'm the Deputy Director of the Division of Site Safety and Environmental Analysis, and I've led all the visits except for the initial ones to the Army Corps sites. We interact with them weekly. We set up a process that allowed the licensees to ask any question they wanted through an early meeting before they got their hydrographs from the results. And through interactions, if they had additional questions, we've provided opportunities for them to submit those to the Army Corps. It is important to recognize that it is not only the Army Corps, but all the organizations that are responsible for dams protect certain information that in the wrong hands could be detrimental to property and life. And that includes dams in Canada, by the way. So we work through a process of working with the Army Corps, making sure the licensees have an opportunity to get any and all the information that they want to be able to take the hydrographs and the other associated information and do the flooding analysis for their sites. It's an ongoing process. We're working currently on the last site, which is on the Columbia River. That involved treaty negotiations with the Army Corps in Canada, because that's all under the Columbia U.S.-Canada Treaty on the Columbia River. And yes, a large dam 900 miles away can cause a lot of damage, and that's the kind of information that is protected. Now, the screening process that we use eliminated thousands, no, I'll say tens of thousands of dams that are in the National Inventory of Dams from further consideration on all the watersheds that we've looked at. In the end, there are only a handful of dams that are of concern, and they are the very big ones, or they're very close. So that's the kind of thing you have to keep in mind when you're discussing, and I'm careful not to talk about any particular dam or river system or what the flooding could be, but those are the kinds of considerations. I will point out that the review that we've done is consistent with what the Army Corps does, what Bureau of Rec does, what FERC does. We've had a lot of cooperation with those agencies in this process. And the licensees have been able to see all that information. It's just the transfer of information of a particular nature to licensees is, or to anybody outside that sphere, is controlled.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm over my time.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Austin.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you all for being here and for your work and the work of your teams. I'll also echo Commissioner Svinicki's thanks to Troy for representing the regions here, and it's very good to see you, Troy. Not surprisingly, I'm going to follow my colleague, Commissioner Svinicki, in doing some reflection here for, I think, some important reasons, that this is, we're the two that were here when this started off, and at least I'll be here another few weeks, but this is my last chance publicly to thank the staff for all their work on all the Fukushima issues, whether it be at headquarters or in the regions, but also to provide just some individual commissioner perspectives on this, because I think it is important to take stock of where we are today in 2016. And I'm gonna make a couple of comments, some of which are really to add my voice to that of Christine Svinicki's here. I remember very clearly when, in the week after Fukushima, when the commission voted to not shut down nuclear power plants in the United States because we believe they were safe. I think that gets, that whole historical fact gets missed in many discussions today. Along with Commissioner Svinicki, I was here when the commission unanimously endorsed having a near-term task force effort to look at areas that we ought to look at, but not to say, yes, go out there and immediately implement everything that this task force does. And I think that has been mischaracterized in a number of congressional hearings. The commission did not go forth and say, go tell us what to change in our regulations. It says, go look at those areas and recommend what areas of our regulatory process and substantive regulations should we explore based on what we know in 2011 in Fukushima. That has been mischaracterized so many times, I felt it was important to try to clarify today. These are areas to look at, then we'll decide what regulatory actions, if any, are appropriate. That's probably the most single significant inaccuracy I've seen in the press in the last 5 years. In July of 2011, I remember Bill Borcher was sitting exactly in your spot, and I said, Bill, what were the key lessons learned? And Chairman Burns hit on this briefly in his questions today. What were the key lessons learned from our experience as a regulator based on Three Mile Island? And I remember very clearly Mr. Borcher saying, a lot of things were ordered by the NRC. A lot of those activities added safety value. A lot of them did not. And it was that a lot of them did not that kind of resonated with Commissioner Svinicki and I, and led in the fall of 2011 when SECI 110137 came out, when Marty Virgilio had your job, that we led to this Tier 1, Tier 2, and Tier 3. And I completely agree with Commissioner Svinicki that we knew at that time that all things were not created equal here. There are some that were really of safety significance, some that we needed to look at, that, but would not rise to that same urgent safety issue. And that's exactly how it's played out. Yet there are those critics of the NRC who would suggest that, well, you didn't do all the stuff that was listed, line item 35 separate areas in the, if I remember right, in the near-term task force report. Well, there was a reason for that. I'm not going to ask this question, Mike, but I think you'll just nod your head. I'm not trying to ask a leading question. I do have a law degree. I'm not a practiced, you know, experienced attorney. But in a leading question format, I think that there's been, if you look at the amount of, I'm going to use this as a visual, this amount of work, effort done by the near-term task force report, and I'll magnify that by probably a factor of at least 100 of the number of hours and effort expended by the NRC staff and to look at all of this, but to more fully explore various areas. Is that a fair characterization? Okay. And so that plays into this not being a static approach, it's a dynamic approach. And I think that dynamic approach has served this agency extraordinarily well. It's evolved with time, as knowledge has been learned, and as new things looked at, and as risk assessments have changed. And the fact that we've made some decisions in 2013 and 14 and 15 that were backing off maybe some things we thought might originally be appropriate is not a bad news story. I'd say it's a good news story. And it confirms that we've used solid science and engineering practices, analytical methods to assess the risk and use that to inform our decision making. Again, that piece has also been mischaracterized a number of times in the press. The communications piece, and I appreciate that you talked about the 250 meetings, and I look at my service in the Department of Energy, Department of Defense, and Commissioner Svinicki's talk about the Google hits on public meetings, and in talking to colleagues in the international community of the last 5 years and 2 months since Fukushima, It's been my personal view that we could not have been more transparent. There's no other country that has been as transparent as the United States in discussing these issues and engaging stakeholders. At the end of the day, though, I expect our professional staff, our technically competent staff, to take all that into account and to be able to render decisions, and I think you have. In preparation for a recent speech, I looked at the number of votes I've cast on SECI papers on Fukushima, along with Commissioner Svinicki, it's 25. And all of our votes on websites, I think the record of public meetings is very open and transparent. So for the American public, even though there may be times when people will disagree with decisions we've taken, and that's a fair comment, and I'm not asking for everybody to agree with us, but at least I think it's a fair statement to say that there's been transparency as to how we've arrived at those decisions. And whether somebody agrees or not, you can at least see how individual commissioners came out on different SECI papers. And I think that's a real strength. In the last, I'd say, 6 or 8, maybe 10 or 15 congressional testimonies that I've had an opening statement for, I've been proud to say that I think we're in a good place on Fukushima issues and that we have relied upon solid principles of science and engineering. I feel that way today. And I have confidence that years from now, you, when you look back upon your legacy at the NRC, you'll be able to say that's the case. And I also acknowledge there's a lot of work left to be done, as Mike Johnson said. Earlier, people have commented, I'm going to do a little sidebar here, but I think it's important in the concept of periodic safety reviews. And I've recently discussed these on an international trip with other international regulators just last week over in Spain. I am not a critic of the periodic safety review process, but I think when people ask Ostendorf, well, why don't you do that in the United States, I'd say, well, here's why. And it's been, look at our baseline inspection program. Look at the resident inspectors report to Troy Pruitt and Mark DePauw and Chris Kennedy down in Region 4. Seldom is that rigorous baseline inspection program, from my experience, fully replicated elsewhere. It's not a criticism. It's just, I think, an accurate observation. Look at our component design basis inspection programs, where every 3 years, every plant has a detailed focus area on engineering, performance specifications that looks in an ongoing fashion with a deep dive at a particular aspect of plant safety, our reactor oversight process. I could go on and on down the path. I won't do that, but I'd say that for other countries, periodic safety reviews work well for them. I respect that. I think our systems work well for us, and it's not a when one looks at what we do in the United States, you have to look at the details and do a deep dive on what we do for our inspection program. Otherwise, there's not an, I don't think you'll have an accurate comparison. Mike, I'd encourage you, now this is not something you need commission direction for, and that need not capture this in the SRM, but I think it's important at some point in time, you and Vic McCree can do this, I think it's important to consider capturing a lessons learned from Fukushima. Regulatory lessons learned, not the details, but more the process, the high-level senior leadership engagement that you're uniquely equipped to lead as in your position as having led the Fukushima Steering Committee for so many years and so forth. The other piece that the second sidebar I'll offer is I don't think there's been a full articulation by industry or the NRC, or I'll use the phrase nuclear enterprise, of the importance of operator training in all of this. We don't talk about it enough. I don't think industry talks about it enough either. And I know that a few years ago, I know Commissioner Svinicki will recall at one of these meetings, there was a question about, well, we don't know that operators would carry out these steps. Remember that, where there was a debate maybe 3 years ago on this topic? And I think that was, any question is a fine question, but I think it did not get fully answered from the standpoint that I have complete confidence as a former nuclear plant operator on submarines for many years that the operators in the U.S. industry are highly qualified, are proficient, their ongoing training every X number of weeks is a very strong aspect of their preparation to deal with any casualty, and I think that's one piece that has not received the visibility that's appropriate. Okay, I'm going to stop there, but I appreciate you listening to one commissioner's perspectives. I thank you for all that you and your teams have done. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner. Before we close, any other comments from my colleagues? Well, thanks. I'm pleased we've had this opportunity to discuss the progress to date on the Fukushima Dai-ichi lessons learned activities, as well as the plans for the actions that remain before us to be completed, to hear the perspectives of both the staff as well as other external stakeholders on these issues. Again, we appreciate the informative presentations today. And with that, we'll stand adjourned.